about life, its consequences, our human existence, pondering quantum physics, and thinking about the spirituality, don't we, Vim?
Absolutely.
Yes, that's what I thought. Just before we get onto the serious business of taking a safari, we warm the jaw, because of course there must be speaking. We get the lips going. And the tongue, of course. And that, of course, will help us to speak in a clear and concise fashion when we go live. We are, of course, live already, but not properly live. We're half live. Not really fully live. Vim?
Well, technically we are fully live.
Technically, yes. But spiritually, are we, Vim? Who knows?
I feel alive.
You do feel alive. Well, that is very good. Now we're going off to find Karula, who is, of course, a leopard. Female leopard. She's over there somewhere, we think. Not sure, of course. I will tell you that I'm also supposed to say that you need to click on the bell, I think. I'm not sure if I'm still supposed to say click on the bell, but there's a bell somewhere on the YouTube feed, bottom right, I think. And that means when we go live, you will be notified. Just in case you didn't know when we were going to go live, which would be odd if you were watching now. I've always found that a great paradox, of course. It's like time travel in a film, Vim. You know that? All films. All of them. Always you have a looping problem with the plot. There's always a looping issue with the plot. Anyway, these things that we must suspend. We must just suspend our disbelief. For this, of course, there is no disbelief here, is there, Vim? No. It is entirely real. This is reality television. Well, exactly, what is reality? There is a diker. Is it real? Is it a dream? Is it just some kind of figment of my imagination? Could be a dream because it's so very early in the morning. Not even yet 5 o'clock. Now, of course, if we don't find a leopard, it is Vim's fault because he told us to come this way. The other thing one needs to do during the pre-drive is warm up one's back so that one might look backwards into the lens and also not crash. That's also very important. Rebecca, have I been doing what? I don't know what Budokon is. Oh, yes. Yes. No, that was much too sophisticated. It's blustery out here. We might have to huddle under a bush. Did I do Muay Thai in Thailand? Rebecca, no, I'm afraid not. I sat on the beach mostly and quaffed fine cocktails. Wasn't much in the way of Muay Thai. 20 seconds to live. Maybe we will stop here.
This program features live coverage of an African safari and may include animal kills and carcasses. Viewer discretion is advised.
And a very good morning to all of you and
standing by.
You are live, you are live.
And a very good morning to all of you, and welcome on a cold and windy sunrise safari on another beautiful morning. My name is Jamie, and this morning I have Brian back from leave. And of course, whenever Brian comes back from leave, the thumb comes back from leave as well. It's funny that. I wonder if there's a connection at all. We're coming to you live from Juma Private Game Reserve, which is in the Greater Kruger National Park area of South Africa. And we're starting off our morning with the wonderful herd of impala that lives on quarantine. And they've been absolutely hilarious. Well, I think they've been hilarious this morning, although shame. I understand the reason for their panic. Well, they've got all of these little babies. It seems as though we've gone from one to about 50 in the space of just a week. Last night was stormy. We had an absolutely massive storm. The wind was howling. And as a result, this morning, the impala could be described as somewhat nervous. And I think that would be the understatement of the century, wouldn't you say, Brian? They have been dashing around like maniacs. The poor babies race off with the rest of the herd. Then they keep panicking, so they keep running. And then the moms try to run after them to catch them. And the babies think that they have to still keep running, so they keep running. And it has been thoroughly entertaining to watch, because as soon as the females start running, then the males think it's time to try and mate with them and chase them around, which causes even more panic. All in all, a normal morning here in the bush. Not only are these safaris live, but they are also interactive, which does mean that you can send through questions, and you can do that on #safarilive on Twitter, or you can email through to questions@wildearth.tv. But just take a moment to let the magic of these little impala sink in. All of them are just a few days old, some of them are just a few hours old, and they're already panic! They're already equipped with the skills that they need and the coordination and the speed that they need in order to help them stay alive. Last night, as I said, would have been perfect, perfect. What are you doing, you mad creature? Look how fast it is! Bounce, 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 bounce. I think this is actually just full of the joys of spring. Whoopsie. Watch out. Now you've got to find mom, little one. Last night was perfect hunting weather for the predators. I have no doubt that Karula was stalking around the edge of quarantine yesterday evening, searching for a potential meal, and I would not be at all surprised if she was not successful. And these poor creatures, on stormy nights, they can't see, they can't hear. There's chaos and disorientation due to the storm. And as a result, it does make them relatively easy pickings, particularly for panicked impala lambs. These are the lucky, the lucky survivors, though. Now, of course, the females have to try and reunite with their babies. Oh, nope, mom, I'm not interested. I want to go and jump. I want to go and spring around, because I can. Poor mom. Nope, she's going to stop and have some breakfast instead. Our impala celebrating the fact that these ones, at least, have made it through the night unharmed. Hop, skip, and a jump. Back again. And the air this morning, apart from the howling wind, which unfortunately means you won't be able to hear it, but apart from the howling wind, is filled with the deep grunts of the mothers calling to their little ones. It sounds a little bit like a croak. Oh. 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 And that's just all of the mothers attempting, after their morning panic, to reunite with their little ones once again. I tried to do a head count of baby impala. It was completely futile. I challenge you to try and count them when they're sprinting around like this. Are we being talking about the Queen of Juma and the fact that she was probably patrolling around this morning? I know that James spoke about searching for her this morning. Let's go across to him so that he can say his proper good morning to you all.
Good morning, everybody, and welcome to this end of the Sunrise Safari. Of course, those of you who watched the pre-show would have seen me already. but not in quite this light. My name is James Henry. On camera today, Wim Doornbraak. Very nice. That is Wim's flashy thumb. You can see that flashes in and flashes out. And I must just say that over the course of the last 10 days or so while I've been away, Wim has sprouted a spectacular-looking beard. Which, of course, in the summer is, I think, a very bad idea, but he doesn't seem to agree with me. It keeps the flies away, does it? Well, that's very good. Maybe I should grow one, too. Enough of that. Right. Now, we are, of course, live, like Jamie is live. Hashtag Safari Live. Questions at wildearth.tv if you want to talk to us. And indeed, you are encouraged to talk to us as much as you'd like to over the course of the next 3 hours. We've come to here, where we are, on the far sort of western fringes of our Juma traversing area. Of course, we can go further west into Arethusa, should we so choose. But we've come here because Wim, of course, was watching Karula yesterday with Brent. I think it was with Brent. And she came through this area. And we were hoping to try and pick her up, perhaps in a tree, perhaps attached to the back end of a very small impala lamb. Perish the thought, but of course it is a good time for impala lambs and an equally good time for the predators. So that's why we're around here. We'll see what we can come up with. Otherwise, I'm sure there'll be something else interesting during the course of the day. Good. On we go. It is supposed to be 19 degrees Celsius, 67 Fahrenheit. I think the wind is a little chillier than that, which of course after yesterday, which felt fairly volcanic, is unusual. Anyway, we're very grateful for it. We're very grateful for the rain that we had last night, and we're very grateful for the cooling breeze that blew through our rooms this morning and gave us cause to put a sheet over our bodies as opposed to lying there in a pool of our own sweat. Not so, Wim? Yes. You've acclimatized, have you? That's very good. You haven't slept with a fan this whole summer? Ah, I'm surprised you haven't been carried away by the mosquitoes. You've got a mosquito net. Right. He's got it all worked out, does our Wim. Now we'll stop over here and have a little bit of a listen to see if we can hear the crunching of bones. And we'll also look in her... Well, one of her favourite trees. One of her favourite trees. I've seen her in it once. Just looks like such a good leopard tree. That's that one over there. And we have seen her in it once. Do you see her there, Wim, now? Do you see the draped, spotted pelage lying across one of the boughs? No. Oh, well, let's keep scanning through here. I don't hear the crunching of bones, nor do I see the sleek shape striding across the plains. Right, let us continue on our merry way. There we go. I have seen one or two little impala lambs this morning, and I must say it's such a lovely time of the year, isn't it, when they're all around? I think it's just great. And of course they hadn't arrived by the time I left, nor had the woodland kingfisher. But now they are both here, as is that tortoise who is seemingly in reverse. Did you see it in reverse?
Yeah.
There it goes. Unless it's a push-me-pull-you tortoise, yes. I've never seen a tortoise in reverse before. You know what? I wonder if he isn't missing a back leg there. No, he's fine. He was just doing a reverse. That is the Speke's hinged tortoise. And he'll be on the lookout, of course, for the other creatures that come out during the rain, those being the giant land snail. He likes to eat snails. Not with garlic, unfortunately, just plain raw snail. I suppose some of the snails here must taste a little bit like sort of freshwater oysters, perhaps. He's going very fast, of course, and if you happen to be something that likes meat and you move at that speed, well, then your only real option is something like a snail, because other than a snail, it's difficult to imagine what he could catch at that speed. Look at him go, everybody. We're about to lose sight of him as he moves into the sunrise, into the blinding light of the new day. Look at him go, Wim. Isn't it a source of encouragement? He seems to be face-planting quite a lot. There's something very amusing about the way a tortoise moves. All right, we'll just wait for him to move off the road. He looks like he's about to step off the road now. And then we'll carry on past. Oh, he's got a friend coming towards him in the form of a ring-necked dove, picking up the odd seed, possibly an ant or two. The humble dove. Grossly underrated for speed. What legs a bit like mine. It's quite interesting. They're very short. And of course their tracks are all over the place. But they're extremely good flyers. Look, that double sighting there, Viam. Isn't that amazing? We better call it in. Station's located one tortoise, mobile, east. And a ring-necked dove, mobile in circles. Right, Jamie is now hailing me on the radio. Let me talk with her. Standing by. I will tell you what she says, everybody, unless, of course, what she says is very secret. Copy, we will do. She says the tracks of the lions have headed this way. So what we're going to do is go round onto Zoe's Road, and we'll see what's going on there. I'm just going to tell her that we have done the route that she's planning. We did do that route. We went power lines and then down Impala Plains to Bella 90s. Haven't come up with anything here. Righty. Let's carry on. Oh, 1 second. Let me just take out the binoculars. Something looks a slightly tawny coloured and shaped over there. And it is indeed tawny coloured and shaped, being the colour, of course, of dead leaves. Very nice. Okay, let's carry on from here. We're going to have to gently skirt around the tortoise, who has made very indecisive movements. Not decided to go on or off the road. Hello. Hello, Dina. You're a new viewer, which is wonderful to hear from you. Thank you very much for talking to us and for giving us of your time. You say, how many leopards are there in the wild? And is the one that we're looking for with cubs? Well, she does have cubs. Yes, they're 9 months old now. In fact, no, today they are 10 months old. Isn't that interesting? 10 months old today they are, born on the 2nd of February. We know that categorically, or the night of the 1st probably, somewhere there. So they're 10 months old today, and so the little female sort of shortly to go independent, probably in about 4 or 5 months or so, and the male, he'll be at home a little bit longer. Then, you want to know how many leopards there are in the wild, and the answer is that nobody has any cotton flying clue how many there are because they're so secretive. So in an area like this, we're pretty much sure that in the Sabi Sand, which is where we are now, of course there's a diker, if you can believe it. Is it running? Forward. It's gone. There it goes. Never mind, everybody. There's a running, tiny little antelope. There we go. You saw it flash. Dina, as we drive into the sun, in an area like this, in the Sabi Sand, I think there are probably about 80 leopards I worked out. We know pretty much all of them. Well, we don't know them all, but you know the guys around this area know them all. But that's just because we move through this area all the time, and so it's through familiarity that we've come to know them. But leopards are extremely resilient, and they can live just about anywhere. So we don't know exactly the extent of their range. We don't know exactly the extent of how big their territories are and where they exist in places outside of protected areas. So there are vast swathes of Africa, of course, where there are no national parks and not a huge number of people. Leopards must be there. We don't know how many there are. And of course, the leopard is one species, but there are a number of different subspecies that of course go all the way to the far east of Russia and into China. So there's an Indian subspecies, there's a Middle Eastern subspecies, there's the Amur leopard, of which there are only 50, believe it or not, which is very sad. That's in the far east of Russia. There are Chinese leopards, there are snow leopards are completely different species, they're not the same thing. But they're going to India, our normal, our leopards, and I mean even down into the Cape of South Africa. So it really is very difficult to say how many there are. And so for many years they were considered sort of unendangered, that they were least threatened or unthreatened. But to give them any kind of designation on that red list of the IUCN, is it IUCN? Yes, it is silly, because we just don't know. They could be highly endangered, they might be not threatened. But they're, because of this lack of knowledge, many leopard researchers have got together and very successfully managed to lobby against the hunting of leopards, and you're no longer able, I don't think, to hunt them in South Africa legally. Which is great, I think. Dina, thank you for your question and thank you for being with us. It's a gorgeous morning now. The sun has just peeped up over the eastern horizon. There's a Stirling's barred warbler going. But what there isn't is a leopard or a lion. Now, of course, we had some rain last night, which means that any tracks would have been obliterated on the ground. And there will be a bit of a crust on the ground, which makes finding the actual tracks of the animals a little bit difficult. But it is doable. Oh, hang on. Now, for those of you who are interested in the birds, I've misidentified a bird call here. I said it was a Stirling's barred warbler. You hear that, Vim? Tuck, 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 tuck. There. Yes, it is that one on the termite mound. You're a genius. No, it's not. Oh, that's a very special little bird. I'll tell you about that now. The bird I'm hearing is this thing called a Nedeki. And it sounds a little bit like a Stirling's barred warbler. So the Stirling's barred warbler goes tick-a-dick, 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 tick-a-dick. And the Nedeki just goes that. Tick, 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 tick. Very similar tone. The bird there on the top of the termite mound is a cinnamon-breasted bunting. Isn't it? No, that's not the same. That's not a cinnamon-breasted bunting at all. It could easily have been a Nedeki. Do you think it was? Let me just get the book out, everybody. Nedeki is a kind of cisticula, which is not, of course, a particularly astounding-looking bird. I just quite like it because I can identify the call, which makes me feel very skillful, you see. Let's find it here, cisticula. 368. Old school, you see, we're going with the book. There it is. No, that wasn't it on the termite mound. Number two there. And there are two of them calling here, and they're actually quite pretty. Anyway, that was that one. I'm not sure what that was on the end of the termite mound there. I thought there was a cinnamon-breasted bunting to start with. Let's just have another quick look there, if you don't mind, Vim.
He's gone.
I know he's gone, but I'm not sure that there weren't two birds there. Negative. Can't see anything here. All right, let's carry on along here. Just get my radios out the way. There they are. There's either about to be a major electrical fault, or there's a beetle stuck somewhere in the bowels of this vehicle. I suspect quite strongly it's the latter. And so every so often there's a disturbing buzzing sound that comes from underneath VM's feet. VM, you don't have a beetle in your shoes, do you? You can see him. Is he big? VM is now going to catch the beetle, everybody. There he is. It's a dung beetle. Thank you, Chris Rogue. While we look at this beetle, you say Mfumo, who is, of course, fast becoming what we think is the dominant male of the Birmingham coalition, he and Amber Eyes were on the dam camera not too long ago. Chris, can we have a time on that? It'd be great. And if you know where they went, that would be even greater. This is not a particularly clever dung beetle. I think we're going to release him into the wild. Be free, little one, be free. Go and find some foul excrement to eat for breakfast. I'm afraid he didn't open his wings and fly off. He just kind of thudded onto the ground. But I think he'll be okay. All right, let's in fact go up that road there because no one's driven it yet. Gosh, that is a very golden sky. It's magnificent. Now, of course, the other thing that's happened since I've been away is that there's been a massive amount of rain, well, relative for this area, all over the place, and not just concentrated on Juma. And so that great swathe of general game that was all over the place has now dissipated, unfortunately. It's not unfortunate for the game, of course, because they've now got lots to eat wherever they are. But there is not a lot going on here at the moment. And, well, that's completely normal. It's completely fine. It means that there's lots of stuff for the animals to eat. I suspect the buffalo will recover. Oh, and also, of course, the good news seems to be that those lions, which were looking... I mean, I was rather afraid that when I got back here, we wouldn't have any lions at all. But the Nkuhumas seem to have almost recovered from that white muscle disease. Whether that is true or not, I'm not sure. But they certainly don't seem to have lost any others while I've been away. They'd lost two cubs by the time I left. And now they seem to still have six, and the adults seem to be looking better, so that's really good news. And I'm sure the buffalo are starting to look a bit better too, as the grass starts to grow a bit longer. Now let's keep an eye out on the road here for tracks. See if we can't pick up some footprints of cats, or indeed an elephant. I'd quite like to see an elephant today. In the meantime, Jamie does actually have tracks, so let's head across to her and find out what they are and where they're going.
While James is searching for the mysterious Queen of Juma, we have encountered some lion tracks that are telling us one very confusing story. Now, unfortunately, on mornings like this, just after the rain that we had last night, not that we're not very grateful for the rain, but it does make tracking particularly difficult. And I mean, these lion tracks are nearly impossible to see. We can't even really put them on camera for you because they are just that difficult. They're basically just little traces in the sand. And the only way I saw them was because the sun caught them at exactly the right angle. And there you go, that's a lion track, believe it or not. You can't really see them. It's next to impossible. The confusing thing about these lions, and by the way, thank you for those of you that sent through the update about Mfumo and Amber Eyes on the dam camera. I'm sure that they are somewhere in the vicinity. The question is whether or not she managed to reunite with the rest of the pride, or if he managed to stop her from doing so, as he's been doing for the last few days. So, Amber Eyes, by the way, is a female, and Fumo is one of the males of this area. So the lions came from there, walked out onto the road, from what I can see from their tracks, and then walked that way, except there's tracks coming this way as well, and then there's tracks going that way, and tracks going that way, and basically tracks going in every direction, every possible direction. And it's not just, if it were just the cubs tracks, that would be easy enough to understand, because cubs scamper. They run ahead and they come back and they rub heads with each other and then they run ahead again. So that would be easy enough to understand, but it's actually females crisscrossing backwards, and obviously they were hunting something. The question is, which way have they gone now? So basically what I'm going to do is I'm going to try and eliminate every option. We'll drive all the way along in the direction that most of the tracks seem to be going. If we don't have any luck there, we'll come back and go back into where they came from, because that's where some of the tracks seem to be going back to. But it might have been that the females hunted something, came back to fetch the cubs, and then went back again. Interesting. Rusty seems to object to starting this morning. It's fine. She starts in the second time round every time. It's just the first time. Perhaps Rusty is having a little bit of a late start this morning. Okay, so thank you for those of you who sent through the update that at 3 a.m. the lions headed towards Central Road. So that tells me immediately that Amber Eyes is going in the opposite direction to where the rest of her pride is moving. And the rest of the pride seem intent on going towards Arethusa. Okay, so they've gone off the road here. That's inconvenient and makes life a bit more tricky, but that's okay. We'll go and check the boundary, and if we don't have any luck there, then we'll come back here. So, Amber Eyes off in the opposite direction to the rest of her family group. I always wonder, right, my cap is attempting, I lent it to James yesterday and it's now slightly larger than it was before. I always wonder if in a situation like that, when you've got a female like Amber Eyes mating, I'm sure she does know where the rest of her pride is, but she can't always know because they're constantly moving and the Nkumas are being quite quiet, as far as I know. I mean, it would have been difficult to hear them last night, but I didn't hear anything. I often wonder whether or not the lionesses that have been separated by the rest, from the rest of their pride, because they're about to come into estrus and start mating with a male, I wonder if she knows where they are. Or if she's just aimlessly wandering around until she finds them. We'll never really know the answer to that question. I think she probably has a rough idea, but she might not know exactly where they are. And she definitely, all she really wants to do is get back to the pride, and all he wants to do is keep her all to himself, which is standard lion courting behavior. And they must, at this point, I would have thought, be mating, which will make finding them a great deal easier because it's quite a noisy affair. It's quite a regular, quite a noisy affair. So we should be able to hear their growls and snarls. But first, let us try and focus on finding the Nkumas because I haven't seen them for a long time and I'm anxious to see how they're looking. They've been looking so much better. I want to see the cubs playing once again and having a ball full of energy just like they were before. Sorry, I've got a sneeze that's stuck. I need to sit and look at the sun for a while, or look in the direction of the sun. Lion or log? Termite log mound thing. I don't think from your height, Brian, I don't think you can see it. I think that branch is directly in the way, and I think it is just a log. It's a log that looks a lot like a lion, in my defense. No, it's a log. Could easily be a lion. We've got to stop to check these things, or else one day we'll drive past something that is in fact a lion. Okay. I'm going to be checking this boundary most thoroughly to see whether or not they've crossed into Arethusa or Simbambili potentially. While we do that, it seems as though James has found more prancing impala for you.
Not entirely sure these aren't the very same impala that Jamie had at the beginning of the drive. Anyway, they're in such gorgeous light now and all the little babies have come. And of course, as we know, the impala give birth within sort of 2 weeks of each other. All of these ewes will have dropped their lambs. Oh, it's very sweet. And how they know who each other are is just completely beyond me. Now, they don't cross-suckle, of course. Gosh, that's quite vicious feeding, isn't it? They don't cross-suckle, and so every impala lamb must find its own mum amongst this great plethora of life here. And how she manages to do that, or how he manages to do that, I'm really not sure. It must be, I think, to do with smell. And I was reading quite a lot about smell yesterday, actually, and I think it's difficult for us to conceive of how well animals are able to smell in comparison with us. For example, something like a bloodhound, which of course it has a very sensitive nose, has the sensitivity of smell, they've worked out, about 40 times what ours is. And then I think there was some other animal he was talking about, forget what it was, I think it was a badger or something like that, 7 times that of a bloodhound. So the ability of these animals to smell and pick up the very slightest scent on the wind that we wouldn't come close to even sniffing, I think is very strong. And so I'm sure every one of these impala ewes smells subtly different from the others, and I think that's probably how these youngsters manage to find their mums. And often when we're watching them, we hear that sound, that wonderful sort of grunting sound, that bleep, 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 bleep. And I for a long time thought that was the youngsters calling, and it often isn't. It's often the mums that are calling their youngsters. Very sweet. I'm going to sit and watch these things forever. Already you can see they've started to eat grass and vegetation. Dale, you're wondering how many babies there are out here. Now, Dale, ordinarily I would say that's an impossible question to answer, but today I'm going to give it a go. And I'll tell you why I'm going to give it a go. I'm going to give it a go because we know that in the Sabi sand, I think they last worked out that there were probably about 3,500 impala. Now, half of those, of course, are females, which brings us to 1,750 or so. And of those 1,750, I'm going to say roughly 1,000 of them are of breeding age. And I know that about 90% of those are going to give birth every year. So I'm going to say roughly, Dale, 900 baby impala around the Sabi sand right now. Could be more than that. In fact, sorry, I think there were 5,000 impala, not 3,000, in the Sabi sand. And so we'll push that up to roughly 1,500 to 2,000 young baby impala at the moment. Beautiful Viam, backlit impala. Hello, Twinkle Glitter. Twinkle Glitter? That's a very interesting name. You say, do impala ever have twins? It's funny, it's such a common question, you know, and I think it's been recorded once or twice. I think it's highly unlikely that they'd both survive. Don't run into us, little fellow. You'll get a nasty headache. The males still chasing each other around, unable to be friendly to each other. Twinkle Glitter, I think that it's unlikely, and I think because of the size of the fetus and its level of development, its sort of precociousness, if you like, I think it's highly unlikely that they'd both survive, because the fetus is so big in comparison with the size of the female that I think twins would really struggle. I'm sure it has happened. Certainly elephants, we know every so often elephants produce twins. Lovely sound. But nothing sounds particularly terrified or alarmed by life. Isn't that astounding? That thing is probably less than a week old, and yet it is running and hopping and skipping and jumping. That's the sound I was talking about. It's gorgeous there. Gorgeous, gorgeous shot there. And the wooden kingfishers have just woken up. Chip purr, they say. Righty. Arcoon Pace. I think I've lost. Yes, Arcoon Pace. Right, Arcoon Pace. You say, do any impala lamb break their legs jumping? I do not believe so, no. I'm sure that if they were to run into a hole, I think that's one of the greatest dangers for breaking a leg out here. If you run into a hole that a subterranean burrow, and you get your wrist stuck in it and then will go over on it, I think that's the greatest danger for breaking it. But no, I don't think they break their legs while they're jumping. I think they've adapted to it. And they come out of the womb incredibly strong. We'll see what else we can see. I was hoping maybe Karula had turned around and come back towards where we are going now. Gosh, the wind doth blow this morning. You can hear some parrots, some brown-headed parrots to the front. Pew! Pew! It's like a sort of gentle scrape along a blackboard with a nail. It's not a particularly attractive sound. But otherwise, things really have greened up rather beautifully. Now, I believe that Miss Patterson may have had some form of success, but we're not going to go across to her just yet. There are some two more impala ewes without babies. Hopefully they haven't lost them to Karula. I'm going to get a little bit quicker around the corner here. Michael, you're wondering about the age of sexual maturity of an impala ewe. You say, at what age will they first mate? Well, of course, they're born now, and next year they'll be a year old. They won't mate by then. The year after that, they will be 2 years old, and then when the next breeding season comes, they'll be about 2.5 years old, and that was probably when most of them will have their first mating, at about 2.5 years, in the May of their third year. That makes sense. So they're born in November or December, well, normally November, so November 2017, they will be a year old. 2018 they'll be 2.5, and then in May 2019 was probably the first time that the new females will mate. Now there is a nyala. Two nyalas. And they're enjoying the company of the impala. I'm sure they too find the sight of frolicking youngsters very sort of takes them back to their youth, you know. And I think of all the antelope that coped, had to cope with the exactly as I was saying, that had to cope with the drought, I think the nyala did the best. I don't think it affected them particularly badly at all. Gosh, the light really is fantastic. Right, let me move up through here. We'll have another look at them. Right, Jamie Patterson, everybody, has had success, but it would seem that the lions are not very excited about it.
I have indeed had success, and that was actually far too easy. I was just saying to Brian, at some point I'm going to pay for the ease with which we found these lions. I drove onto our western boundary, or Juma's western boundary, saw all of the tracks in the mud, looked up, and there the lions were. Now there you have it, a relatively easy sighting, but we've got to be very grateful because the Nkuhumas are about 50 metres or so away from our boundary. So we are really, really lucky this morning that we managed to catch up with them. Now there are 4 lionesses and all 6 happy, healthy little cubs, which is a fantastic way to start off whatever morning, whatever day of the week this morning is. I think it might be Friday. It's either Friday or Saturday. And I'm whispering, or not whispering, I'm speaking quite softly just because there is one very dozy lioness quite close to us. I don't want to disturb her slumber. So there you have it. I was expecting the Nkuhumas to have a meal with them this morning, but judging by their relatively foolish bellies, they actually might have eaten last night. They might have caught something relatively small. And the reason that our Nkuhumas are spending more and more time in the western fringes of our traverse area, and occasionally right outside of our traverse area, so to the north of us in a place called Simbambili, they're actually after buffalo, as they usually are, and Juma doesn't really have any more buffalo. All of the buffalo have moved to the slightly better grazing areas now that the rest of the Sabi sand has had rain. So I think our kahumas did manage to eat. It was just a slightly smaller meal than that of a buffalo. So exciting stuff, and for those of you that are new to these live safaris, it is my pleasure to be introducing you to the Nkuhumas. They are the pride of lions that we actually spend the most time with. We've just seen them come through a battle with a nutritional deficiency as a result of the drought that ultimately took claim the lives of two cubs, but at one point it looked like it might claim the lives of more. Even the adults started to show symptoms of it. But it is with utmost relief that we can say that they've come through it. They obviously just had the right meal at the right time, and they are looking far, far better. Brian, I know when you left, it was probably at its worst. It's nice to see that they are, it's hard to see right now because they're flat, but they are looking a huge amount better. So there we go. 4 Nkuhuma lioness, minus Amber Eyes, of course, and a bundle of cubs. Unfortunately, I wouldn't call this the easiest place in the world. Brian and myself had to do some serious ducking and diving to get into them. But there's still a good chance. It's quite cool this morning, so there's still a good chance that they might actually get up and move at some point in the not-too-distant future. There we go, cubs heads up. Go on. Go wake your siblings and your cousins. It's time to play now. Oh. Maybe not. Maybe it's time to go back to sleep. Yes, little one. I say little. They're really not so little anymore. They're like gangly teenagers. Wait till you see them stand up, Brian. They look different. They really do. They're massive. We saw the Styx cubs not too long ago, the new ones. And it took me right back to when the Nkuhumas were teddy bears. Brian was with me when we first saw the Nkuhuma cubs, when we saw the very first set of cubs of this generation when they were all lined up on Nyala Road North. And they looked like little perfect teddy bears, teddy bear lion cubs. They're also looking incredibly healthy in terms of their mange. They did get mange briefly, and it seems as though all of them have pretty much kicked it. They are far better. I'll just bear with me, sorry. I did try and call this sighting in earlier, but I don't think anybody's heard me. And I just want to try once more. Can any station copy me? Yes? No? Oh well, I guess it's all ours, Brian. For now, until someone gets a little bit closer. And a very good morning to Twinkle Glitter. I hope you are feeling mighty sparkly on this gorgeous morning. Twinkle Glitter, you wanted to know what's the most cubs I've ever seen a lioness have. I've actually never seen a lioness with more than 3 cubs, now that I think about it. I have only ever seen a lioness with 3 cubs. The record is 6. That's the absolute maximum that a lioness can have, but you usually find they average from between 2 to 3. In one litter. But then of course, well, we've got 6 cubs here. One of the things that lionesses do best is look after each other, and they do that in terms of cubs by synchronizing their estrus cycles, and as a result all of the cubs are born roughly, not all of them, a lot of the cubs are born roughly at the same time, and as a result they will allosuckle each other's cubs. So the fact that one is the mother of just 2 out of, say, 6 cubs doesn't mean that she won't feed the other 4, which is what we've seen with the Nkuhumas. Even when there were 8 cubs still, and the poor females were lying there positively under siege by several cubs pushing and sort of scrapping over access to her nipples. The thing is, lionesses only actually have 4, from what we've seen, 4 fully functional lactating nipples. So it's difficult. Sometimes there's a little bit of competition. I'm going to attempt to... Sorry, I'm just distracted by the presence of a driver ant next to my feet. Oh, there we go. Goodbye. They bite. I'm not terribly chuffed with it swanning about next to my feet. good morning to Rebecca, not in final control, which can actually be quite confusing. Rebecca, you wanted to know how long the gestation period is for a lion. It's usually between about 95 to 105 days, but let's say on average about 3 or just over 3 months. Obviously, it is much like any other animal out here or any human being. It is dependent upon the individual. So some are pregnant for ever so slightly longer. Although you don't have the wide range that you do get with human beings, it's usually within the space of about 10 days leeway, 5 days on either side, that lionesses will give birth. And compared to the impala that James was talking about earlier, obviously for such a big animal, it is about half the gestation period of an impala, but unlike the impala babies that are born ready to spring about within a couple of minutes of their births, lion cubs are altricial. So they're born very underdeveloped, with their eyes closed and their ears flat against their heads, and their teeth aren't fully erupted yet. So all in all, they are completely helpless. The mother has to hide them away. And it is only within the space of about 6 weeks that they will really start to be introduced to the pride, and only really at about 8 or more weeks that they will move with the rest of the pride. Let me see if I can get the attention of this person driving past. Hold on a moment. Is it a civilian car or is it a game drive vehicle? Station on Triple M for Jamie. Sorry, hold on a moment. Okay, I clearly don't have any comms at all on my game drive radio, which is most unfortunate. Luckily, we have it on record. Standing by. That's affirmative, Ryan. I've been trying to call in for the last 10 minutes. You're welcome to join me. There we go. Ryan is on his way in. Perfect. Now I don't have to worry so much. I was starting to sit here feeling really guilty. Not that it was my fault, but I was feeling relatively guilty about the fact that nobody else knew they were here. It is a very tricky area, so at some point we might need to play shuffling around with the car a little bit. Okay. And good morning to Red as well, you wanted to know, because we spoke about how altricial lion cubs truly are. Aw, settling down at the back there. You wanted to know exactly how long a lion cub will be without sight and without teeth. And I'm not 100% sure. I think it's only a matter of a couple of days before the eyes start to unpeel and to open up. And I think that for teeth, they erupt relatively soon as well. But for those of you that perhaps have Google at your fingertips, if you could let me know exactly what the time span is, I think it's only a couple of days. Oh. I love watching the interactions of these lions with each other. The bonds between the siblings and the cubs is just utterly adorable. Oh, everybody's waking up now. Some bright-eyed looks. Oh, and back to sleep. See? Look at the round belly on that cub. It's not the fattest we've ever seen them, but it looks to me like they have had something to eat last night. Could have been something relatively small, like a zebra. Oh, unfortunately, with the rain has come a few gremlins, and we do need to do a little bit of a reboot on our side, or at least in the final control room, which is where all of the magic actually happens. That's not true. The magic happens here, but where some of the magic actually happens. So what we're going to do is we're going to disappear off your screens for 2 minutes, and then we will be back once again. So please don't disappear anywhere. We will be back with you shortly. We just need to do a little bit of a reboot after the rain and the electrical storm. So we will see you in just
Now we are on the Gowrie cut line, everybody, because we've come here on the back end of some information from Chris Rogue that there was a male and female lion at the Pan and that they headed towards Central Road, which is, interestingly enough, the most central road on Juma. We didn't find any further tracks there. We did see the tracks going towards the Pan, so we're just kind of doing a loop around there. You know, it's so difficult to find leopard tracks in conditions like this that I've kind of given up on Karula at the moment, because you can see now that the sun's come out, and if you look at the road in front of us, you might just be able to see that it looks like there's a bit of a crust on it. So you don't leave much of a track. So if I was to, let me just give a demonstration, shall I, Viam? It's nice to get out of the car when it's a little bit blustery. So if I walk, can you see my feet here? If I walk here, you will notice that despite my vast mass of 68 kilograms, I'm not leaving much of a sign. Now if you're Karula with much more gentle feet and you're walking along a crusted surface like this, you really don't leave much of a sign at all. So if I put my hand here and push down, there's very, very little give. I think I heard a vehicle in the distance and mistook it slightly there for growling of an animal. Anyway, we might be lucky. We'll see what happens. Let me find my wire to plug in again. There we are. Favoured this area for the last little while, so we might be lucky with them. Alternatively, the young male leopard who they spotted in this area yesterday, that Brent came to look for early yesterday afternoon, maybe he will make an appearance. Of course, there are also lots and lots of interesting flowers and insects now, and it was great being on walk yesterday afternoon and just looking at some of the smaller stuff. My microphone has now detached itself from my body, which is deeply irritating. Luckily, I managed to hold it together. There we are. Okay. All these things you don't think about when you're on holiday. Sorry about our technical glitch there, everybody. I'm not sure exactly what happened. It is well beyond my understanding, but some sort of technical trouble befell us. So we had to go offline slightly. Otherwise, not a great deal going on here. Ooh. Month-old female cub of Karula, our most favoured queen, and she... Lael, you want to know what will happen when she goes independent? How will Karula decide which part of her territory to give her? I don't think it's so much a question of Karula making a conscious decision to give her daughter a piece of her territory. I think it's just that Shongile will start to assert her independence, and while Karula won't with her, certainly there will be, if they go on independent, there will be hissing and snarling, as there has been with Shadow and Karula. Shadow is, of course, Karula's oldest daughter. What happens there, of course, once she starts to assert her independence, it's just that Karula's territory will kind of shrink across. All right, sorry, everybody. We're going to head across to Jamie. We don't have much signal. Lael, I'll continue with the story shortly.
It seems as though, unfortunately, James was losing his signal. We're having minor issues with our camera. It seems as though all of the gremlins have attacked on this bright and beautiful morning after the rain and the electrical storm, and the camera's having a little bit of a tantrum. So it's not your screen and it's not our stream. It is, in fact, the camera having a little bit of a moment. Let's see how we're doing. That looks better. There we go. That's a little bit better. The camera actually physically makes a noise when this occurs. It groans and complains. It literally sounds like it's saying, no, I don't want to work this morning. But fortunately, it seems to be okay. The cubs have sort of got up and shuffled around a little bit. They are awake, but not very. Stopping to have a quick bath, along with the lionesses. And then I think it's... They're probably going to get up and move off a little bit further into the dense vegetation. Now, I mentioned earlier that there will be plenty of other vehicles. Maybe I didn't, actually. I can't remember now. I may or may not have mentioned earlier that there will be other vehicles with guests who will, of course, love to share in this experience. So at some point in the next probably about 5 minutes, let's go over to Steph, see what he's got.
Morning. I know it's the first time you're seeing me this morning, but we've got such a big surprise for you. For those who don't know me, I'm Stefan Gendre. Oh, camera today, we've got Gendre. Come look here. We've been tracking a mating pair of lions for at least the last 20 minutes, and we can just see them through there. I'm going to see if I can get you a better view. Come with me. Now with lion, it's vital that they don't see you. If he sees you, he's going to run away. Through the gap there, it's just the back of the head of a male lion. He is absolutely unaware that we are here right now. We're about 100 yards or so away from him. And he's facing away from us. With the wind direction blowing across us both, so he can't smell us. And as long as we're careful, he won't be able to hear us either. Isn't this exciting? African lions on foot in the middle of Juma in the Kruger Park. Now, a lot of you might be thinking, are you crazy? Are you on foot? We're so close to these lions, or they're not going to jump up and immediately gobble us all down. The simple fact is that lions are much more afraid of us than what we should be of them, at least anyway. And quite often, if you give them a fright or you stumble across them, they'll just get up and run away in quite a frenzied panic sometimes as well. Now, what we don't want to do is disturb these animals. I'm not here to make these animals run at us and feel like they're threatened. I in particular don't want this male to feel like he has to defend the female Amber Eyes against us, because that is a recipe for a disaster. So what we're going to do, I'm quickly going to call in James. He's also been looking for these lions. We're going to call in James and see if we can put you right next to those cats in a vehicle. They're much less afraid of people in a car. I'm just going to get the game drive radio quickly. I think if you come here, Gendre, and we go down a little bit, you'll get his face through there. James, come in for Steph. James, we are directly west of the pumped pan at Vuyatela. You should be able to get us visual from the road.
Yeah, copy. I'm just north of the dam.
Oh, yes, excuse me. That west, the north of the dam. A little bit wrong. James should be able to find us using landmarks like roads, prominent bends, pans. We're not too far away from Vuyatela camp right now, probably about 250-300 meters, only 300 yards, and he's still facing away from us. It's typical of a male lion facing away from us, looking where he's going, It's just such arrogance in these male lions, and I love it. It's what makes them male lions. Like I said, we're not going to get closer. That's not the aim of what we do. We've tracked these animals using Aubrey's skill, years of intuition. And we've now seen him before he's seen us, and this is just perfect. The wind direction is still in our favor. And believe me, at this distance, if the wind direction wasn't, he would have smelt us a long time ago. Now, I think we've got James coming quite close to us now. So let me just see if we can see him without creating too much movement here. Go, James. We can see you. You've gone past us, James. Come back again to basically, if you directly north of the pan, of the pumped pan, just come into the block from there. I'll come fetch you. So now we just got James.
East of Mvubu.
All right, what we're going to do is just get James in here, and we're going to send you over to Jamie, and we'll swap over as soon as we've sorted out this radio mess. See you in a bit.
Oh, how exciting is that? Already just an hour into our sunrise safari, and we've already had two different lion sightings. And there's nothing like seeing lions on foot to really get your heart beating first thing in the morning. So I'm sure that Steph is very excited to having seen those lions. I'm assuming it's Amber Eyes and Mfumo. It could also be some of the other Birmingham boys, because I didn't see any Birmingham boys with the Nkuhumas this morning. And speaking of the Nkuhumas, as you can tell, we have left that area. It's a very, very tricky, very dense area, and there's only really one spot where you can see the lions clearly. So I've moved away so that the other guides can actually get their guests into a good position to properly see the lions, rather than just seeing sort of flashes of tawny hidden behind the leaves. So we've left them for now. We might, depending on how the morning goes, we might return to them as it gets a little bit later. But I'm sure there will be lots of vehicles wanting to see them. In that particular area, in those particular spots, it has been relatively tricky for them to actually find lions. The Nkumas have been based on Juma. The Sticks have spent a lot of time south in Mala Mala. So quite a few of the vehicles haven't or don't always get the chance to see lions. So whenever they do have lions on their side, we're more than happy to give them space and return a little bit later, or perhaps for the sunset safari. All in all, it's just friendly neighborly relations. And we're going to head off. I think what we'll do, if James is going to Stefan those lions, then what Brian and myself will do is go and look for the Queen of Juma. Emboldened by our success with the lions, although admittedly that was far easier than tracking Karula, I could ever hope that tracking Karula would be. That was far too easy. But those moments happen, and they're always joyful when they do. There's nothing like looking down at the tracks, checking carefully where they go. I was about to get out of the car and I lifted my head up, and there were the lions. Very convenient of them. So we're back at the original spot where we first had the confusing set of tracks. Now, let us go and try and pick up on where the Queen of Juma has gone. I think we'll go all the way to the southern boundary and then check along there and see if perhaps she's gone. As we said last night, it's very good hunting weather, so there's a good chance that she would have made a kill. We'll go and see if she went and fetched her cubs. Good morning and welcome back to Ilana, who is 13 years old. It's lovely to hear your name again, and thank you for sending through your questions. Now, Ilana, you wanted to know, and I do hope we're saying your name right. If we're not, please let us know. You wanted to know if Karula, if she was sleeping, would there be any other predators that might attack her and her cubs? Yes, quite possibly. Although leopards tend to sleep quite comfortably, I think in the knowledge that their reflexes are quick enough to avoid most things. So even though they look deeply asleep, they're always slightly on alert. We've seen it with Shadow before, where she's been fast asleep and a hyena's basically nearly stepped on her tail before she realized what was happening and shot up and moved off. So generally, the two predators that are likely to really harass a leopard are lions and wild dogs. Hyena, it's unusual. They do with cubs, but again, the Karula's cubs are now relatively large and no longer defenseless. And even a small leopard like Karula, even if she is a good couple of kilograms lighter than your average hyena, she would put up a serious fight, almost to the point that it's not worth it with hyena. So a lot of the times you see hyena and leopard lying up just a couple of meters away from each other, and each one of them knows to just keep their distance. Wild dogs will definitely harass a leopard if they can find it, and we have seen some close calls with leopards and wild dogs before. And lions, of course, are her biggest threat, and the biggest threat to the cubs. And lions, of course, can climb trees, not particularly well though. Generally, a leopard is far better at climbing right up until the tip-top branches, and they'll hide away. And there have been many encounters, and I've seen it before as well, where lions have chased a leopard up a tree and proceeded to stay there for, the one that I saw was nearly 24 hours. They proceeded to watch this leopard intently, determined on catching her. They didn't in the end. Eventually it was a standoff, and eventually one of them, the lions, got bored and they moved off and the leopard could come down with her cubs. But it does happen. So leopards can't afford to be fast asleep. Even though they look it, their ears are constantly working, they're constantly listening for any other sounds of that might sort of intimate a predator on their way. And Karula, of course, also has to be alert for the threat of baboons, which is something we've seen more and more, I say more and more regularly, we've seen it twice in the last 2-3 months. Once with Tundi and her tiny little cubs, and once with Karula and her two slightly older cubs. And generally lions account for the most deaths of adult leopards. Well, sort of. It's a combination, it's a toss-up. For leopard cubs, their biggest threat is another unfamiliar male leopard. For leopard adults, it's probably lions that would be their biggest threat. We saw Tingana have a very, very narrow escape from a lion. He wasn't even asleep. He was just walking and she ambushed him, and it was touch and go for a few seconds because she was at full speed and he was taken completely by surprise. So he had to race to try and get away from her and to stretch out his long limbs to get up into a tree. And it was close. It was very, very close. Although I think that lioness would have had quite a shock if she'd tackled Tingana. I think he would have fought back with serious strength and speed. All right, okay, since you're being so noisy, we'll put you on camera. Oh, fine. Be like that. It's just landed there. The kingfishers, as soon as they arrive back, the strident call, their strident trill, rings out across the bush, and it's positively overwhelming. There's no other bird that features. There we go. There's number two. So this is the woodland kingfisher. James made a very good point that sometimes we get naughty and we call them the woodlands, just in short. They are in fact woodland kingfisher, singular. They're probably a male and a female sitting here. And hopefully we get to see them do their display when they start to trill at each other and then do a little dance. But aren't they beautiful in this morning light? Look how glossy that turquoise is. That, I feel, is the perfect, that's the perfect example of turquoise to me. Ah, so now you're quiet, huh? One call for us? Nope. Stubborn bird. Woodland kingfisher are amongst the most vocal of all of the kingfishers. And yet now, these two, not up for it. Just by the way, you can see how windy it is this morning. The wind is absolutely howling. The woodland kingfishers are sitting in the tree, the silver clusterleaf tree that we've been seeing those caterpillars devour, which is one of the reasons why that one probably doesn't have any leaves. And just to let you know, apparently it is the African migrant caterpillar that's been eating all of those leaves. And that little piece of information came from Brent, who apparently was as puzzled as we were, and he managed to find out a couple of weeks ago. So it's the African migrant or vagrant butterfly. It would definitely be on the menu for these woodland kingfishers. You can see how the wind is blowing at their feathers. Come on, one more call. For us? No. Not having any of it. Now birds, interestingly enough, just with the colours that we're seeing, birds only really, apart from limited exceptions, only really have two types of pigment. One is melanin, and then the other are what's known as carotenoids. And those are generally sort of reds and yellows. So the feathers and the bluish colour that is on the kingfishers is not made by... it's not made by blue pigment. It's actually made by the what's known as scattering of light. So it's different to the glossy starlings. That color is different to the glossy starlings, which is made from reflection of light and the sort of refraction of it that creates that gleam. And the kingfisher's blue color, that turquoisey blue color, and the same applies to parrots, by the way, and their green color, is made by a combination of melanin carotenoids, so the yellows and reds, and then the overlay of keratin to actually scatter the lights. It's amazing to think that all of the range of colors on birds is actually made by dancing light. Not actually speaking of dancing light, I can't even make that connection in my own head. I'm sure you're all wondering how the interaction between James, Steph and those lions is going. Let's go and see if James has had any success.
Well, everybody, the interaction is that Steph and Aubrey and Jean Ray removed themselves from the situation and we came in, which of course is how it should work. It's just beautiful when it works out like that. They tracked them on foot, you had a brief glimpse of them, and then we came in to sit with them in the vehicle. They have now, of course, as you've come to us, gone to sleep. Amber Eyes, which you can't see, of course, because her eyes are indeed shut. That's her there, and that is Mfumo, he who is authoritative over the maggots that attacked his nose. There he is over there. Now, I know Brent was having a little bit of trouble identifying the other males yesterday. I don't blame him in the slightest, I must confess. Were I to see the other two that we don't see very often, I would really struggle to identify them, I fear. And are they all sleeping? And I think it's quite interesting. Amber Eyes does not seem to be pregnant yet. She's obviously still in the state of mating. She's been like this, though, now I think for about 3 months. She's been in and out of sort of proto-oestrus, if you like. And this lion has been following her continuously for that period. And for some reason, she has not conceived. Now, that may well have been wise from a physiological point of view. I don't think she's done it intentionally, given the lack of nutrients that the rest of the cubs have got because of that white muscle disease and the drought. But maybe she will conceive now. And that will be ideal for us, of course, because we go into that 8-week TV series come the beginning of January. And it would be very nice, of course, if we had little cubs for that. So maybe she just wants her cubs to start their lives very famous. There she is. And look, we're not going to spend too long here. Of course, we spend an enormous amount of time with the cats. And we didn't find any tracks of Karula, and I'd still like to go and have a look at them. We've still got a good deal of time left in the drive. So we'll spend a little bit of time with these chaps, I think probably about 10 minutes or so, and just see if they don't mate, if they show signs of mating. And the reason we want to do that is not because we want to be indiscreet or voyeuristic at all. It's because we want to be able to see if she when they do couple, when they do mate, is it a successful mating? Does she make that growling noise as he dismounts and then roll over on her back, which would indicate some kind of success? Or is it, like we've seen many times with her, a kind of perfunctory, you know, he makes a half-hearted job of it, she doesn't seem to be particularly concerned about anything, and then at the end of the day, nothing really happens. And that's what's happened here, I think, over the last little while. Hello, Miss T. You're wondering about their lonesome nature here. How long will they be away from the pride? Well, it's impossible to say, Miss T, because it's very variable. They could be with the pride tomorrow. They could be with them in a few days' time. It really does depend on where the rest of the pride is, whether the rest of the pride has food, whether these chaps realize that the rest of the pride has food, so, you know, that would sort of induce them to go towards the rest of the pride. But the male, remember, of course, is only going to go to the rest of the pride if there's mating or food in the offing. He's not going to go there just to say hello to them. And so his only motivation for trying to go all the way to Arethusa to join the rest of the Nkuhumas would be to get something to eat, not check on how his little ones are doing. And I don't think, you know, I mean, I think the drive for the females when they're in estrus is very strong, so I don't think she necessarily wants to rush across to be with the rest of the pride either at the moment. I think she's probably where she wants to be. There's nothing stopping her going with the rest of the pride, other than the fact that she wants to be with the male. He would just follow wherever she went. If she got up and moved off towards Arethusa, where the rest of the pride are, he would just get up and move with her. At the moment, moving seems to be the very, very last thing on their minds. And the other interesting thing, of course, is that he seems to have chased off the other males. Liz, you say you saw her limping once, and therefore perhaps there's some kind of disease she's picked up or injury that is preventing her from conceiving. No, Liz, I really don't think that's the case at all. These lions, the predators, or, I mean, you often see the predators limping. They often have minor injuries in much the same way that a sportsman who engages in contact sports will have a problem like that. What they do is they tend to... They get knocks and bashes from the games that they play. And I think it's just the same with the lions and the leopards. You know, when they're hunting, they take knocks. They run through this incredibly thick bush. There's no question that they're going to hit stumps, bash things. And then, of course, during the actual hunting, especially if you're hunting buffalo, they're going to get bashed every so often. So I think that's the only reason she was limping. She certainly looks in very good condition to me. She might have a bit of that white muscle disease, which of course caused by an extreme lack of vitamin E, which in turn apparently does not allow for the binding of selenium, which is a very important trace element that we as well need. Oh, look. There's some... That was very well done, VM. I'm afraid I threw you under the bus there. There were some Jacobin cuckoos, everyone. You've got vultures as well. Ooh, there we go. So it's just got hot enough for the vultures to get going. So they're taking off. And interestingly, Amber Eyes became quite enthused by the fact that VM was leaping around. Look at her. She's half opened two of her eyes. Wonderful. High action here at the lion sighting. Overwhelmed. Don't know where to look. Right, I'm pretty sure that that's enough of these lines. What do you think, Vim? Shall we give them 5 more minutes? We'll give them 5 more minutes. Now, I love this question because it opens up so much discussion, Andrew. You're wondering when it is that lionesses stop having cubs. Well, it depends where they live, really. If they live in a zoo where they're fed a good portion of donkey every week, then you'll probably find that they live to about 18 to 20 years at an outside maximum. And then out here, I think you'll probably find that 15 would be an extremely old lioness indeed. They will breed pretty much up until the day that they die, Andrea. They do not lose the ability to breed, and as soon as that happens, they get very old very quickly and they pop their clogs, as it were. So they don't have a menopausal period. Very few animals have a menopausal period. We're an obvious example of one that does. I think one or two of the other primates do, not all of them. And elephants are out here the most obvious example of an animal that has a menopausal period. And that, of course, you find in animals where there is mentorship required, where there is some kind of knowledge or teaching to be gained from older generations. You find that those older animals, or those animals, tend to live into old age. Whereas animals where teaching doesn't take place, lions, wonderful example of where, yes, a cub might be brought something that isn't quite dead yet, but once the cubs are independent, their adults play no further role in mentoring or teaching or anything, or security. And I think that's why you'll find that they are able to breed until they die, and conversely, they die as soon as they can't breed. So Amber Eyes, I think, if we look at her nose, is probably 6 years old now. See how her nose is almost completely black? Let's call her a six-year-old. She's probably got another 7-8 years or so. Yes, they really do not seem to be very enthused about doing anything other than lying in the sun, like recalcitrant teenagers. I suppose they are probably exhausted. Lion mating is a tiring time for them. Viem, shall we continue to find the great queen? I think so. All right, Viem has had enough of these lions. I don't blame him. We're going to carry on. Oh, hang on a second. Viem, look, he's put his head up. There we go. He's put his head down again. Right. This excitement has become overwhelming, everybody, so we're going to head across to Jamie before I become totally flustered by everything and find out what she is trying to find.
And we are heading towards the southern boundary to see what's happening on that side, to see whether or not we can continue our cat streak of the morning. We've started off on a very positive note with the lions, and now we're going to go and help James to search for Queen Karula, who was apparently seen last night on the Sunset Safari. Now she is, or has been, around. It's just a matter of working out where she might be. And on a day like today, with the nip in the air, apparently it was 19 degrees when we started, which is 62 centigrade, and I don't think it's heated up all that much. There is a very cold wind that I think is bringing, hopefully, more rain towards us, but that does mean that the big cats, well, with the exception of the Nkuhumas and the lions with James, that the big cats are going to be moving around. Nope, false alarm, sorry. Sorry, hold on one moment. Andrew's just trying to get an update. There we go. Sorry, I'm just listening to the updates from the Game Drive radio, trying to get an update from the eastern side of our traverse area. So this radio essentially connects us with all of the different vehicles of the area and allows us to plan and to share the sightings that we have. Oh, that's nice. No, don't go. Oh, I wanted to show you a black-headed oriole, but it has flown away. Our birds are not cooperating this morning. They are also blowing all over the place in the sky at the moment. I don't think it can be terribly easy being a bird in weather like this. on windy days like today, trying to hear what other people are saying on the Game Drive radio is very tricky, because of course you talk like this and the wind, all you get is as people are driving along. Morning, Andrew. The Nkumas are on Arethusa, probably about 20 meters away from the Triple M boundary. There's a visual from Triple M itself, but it's about 1 out of 5. Negative. Sorry, Andrew, I couldn't hear you. Please go again with it. Copy that. Thanks very much for the update. Okay, just all of us sharing the various updates. There's a tracks of one male lion on Cheetah Plains, or going towards Cheetah Plains. Hannes, you wanted to say, or you wanted us to find you a European roller, because apparently that would make your day. I saw three of them a couple of days ago, just too quick to put on camera, and then of course Brent did actually have a sighting with the European rollers, so they are back. So I will look for European rollers for you with pleasure. And with you, I suppose. You can all help me look for European rollers. Might be a bit tricky from your side, but we will definitely be looking for European rollers. I'm also in this area looking for a broad-billed roller, which has only been seen once and once only on Drive with Brent, which we're all quite jealous of, because you don't get to see broad-billed rollers here. All part of the roller family, but very different, very brightly coloured, bright yellow bull. And this was the exact spot that he saw it in, if I'm not mistaken. Somewhere around here. Yesterday I heard an update, just while we are in this particular corner. I'm going to be looking not just for Karula, but apparently there was a young male leopard sighted around this area. So we'll be looking for him as well, and I'll give you a bit more detail on that in a moment. But for now, let's go over to Steph and one of the most fascinating beetles. Oh, sorry about that. It seems as though Bushwalk doesn't have any signal. So they will do some repositioning and some shuffling around, and hopefully they manage to get some. As you know, bringing you live, particularly live bushwalks, can be a tricky business, and every now and again the signal disappears. Our cameramen have to walk around with a massive antenna sticking up above their backs, and that is the thing that of course brings you the live broadcast, but it can be temperamental at times. Steph's going to try and do some, or at least Gendre, I imagine, will do some shuffling around. And they'll see if they can show you the fascinating beetle that they have. Right, I was in the process of telling you about the young male leopard that was apparently on this corner somewhere. Now, he was seen by some of the trackers on foot, and he immediately ran away and ran south of our traverse area. Our behavior like that skittish on foot, immediately suggests to me that it was probably Sindile. Sindile is, which is a good thing, since his time spent in captivity in quarantine in order to make sure that he didn't contract rabies, he was obviously treated exceptionally well. It sounds funny to say that, the fact that he's skittish on foot, but the last thing you want with a leopard that is in captivity is for them to become used to people, and used to people on foot. So obviously they did a fantastic job in the center where he was being treated of making sure that he didn't become accustomed to humans. But what that means is that unlike most of our Sabi sand leopard, who are used to seeing trackers on foot and are quite comfortable with our presence, he is not. And he has a tendency, I bumped him once on foot and he ran away from me very, very quickly. He didn't run far, but he did make sure that he was far enough away from me that he felt comfortable. So it seems as though Sindile is back in the area. He has been seen recently just outside of our traverse area. He's been on Torchwood, which is where we can't go, and he's been on Buffalo's Hook, where we can't go. But he has been around, which is good news. It's lovely to hear that he's still in the area and still doing well. doing what young males do best, which is young male leopards, that is, which is move about and search for a nice, safe spot. We've been talking about birds earlier and the fact that they've been hiding from us. It seems as though James has had slightly more success.
There, everybody, is the woodland kingfisher, magnificent bird. But what is interesting, of course, is that it's caught a burrowing scorpion. Oh, now let's just watch. Did you see where it went?
It didn't come out this
way. Let's just go forward. I'll tell you why. Because what they will, he'll probably do is beat it to death by smashing it against a branch and breaking all the chitin in the exoskeleton, which then makes it digestible. Now, Rebecca Land, a very appropriate question, of course. You're saying, what does the woodland kingfisher eat? Well, apparently today it eats scorpions, but they eat all sorts of invertebrates, so they don't eat fish at all. They'll eat centipedes. They seem to love centipedes. They will eat termites when they can, backwards. They will eat little small reptiles. So basically anything in that sort of size range there. How's that, Jim? How cool is that? Isn't that wonderful? Now let's just see. I want to see if he doesn't try and bash it. Or she. Might be a she. There's an ant in the background there. He always has to be careful that it isn't stolen from him. I think that is a very dead scorpion already. I'm not sure that he's going to need to do too much beating of it. Imagine that was your breakfast. A burrowing scorpion. Yes. Well, you'd think so, but the last time, Viem just said it looks too big for his little belly. The last time I watched a kingfisher eat, it was the very last kingfisher I saw last season before they disappeared. It ate an enormous centipede that I thought it would never be able to swallow, that thing. It was about twice the size of that scorpion. So just to get back to its general diet, it will basically eat anything around about that size and slightly larger that it can get. So it doesn't have to be an invertebrate. It can be a vertebrate, it can be a reptile, for example. I suspect they probably eat small frogs as well if they can get them. He looks a bit indecisive about his breakfast though. And the other thing is that they will very shortly start to breed, and I'm sure, oh look, he might actually be trying to attract a mate. That opening of the wings is a little dance that they do, and maybe it's a gift for a potential mate. That beautiful blue colour, iridescent almost. Ah, oh, it's stunning. Look at the way the blue subtly goes onto the back of his head. All the way around that kind of grey colour there. Isn't that great? And that's iridescence, people. That is not a pigment, as far as I'm aware. No, sorry, it is a pigment. I'm talking rubbish. For these birds, it is a pigment. Gorgeous. Now come on, swallow it. Or at least do something with it. Yes, it doesn't look like that scorpion is particularly enthusiastic about life anymore. I think it has shaken off this mortal coil. They're all over the place now, these woodland kingfishers calling. There we go. Come on. There we go. Now there, it's just, what it's doing there is crushing the chitin. So the chitin, you all know, of course, that an invertebrate like this has got an exoskeleton, which means that it's got a very hard sort of shell that is made of indigestible chitin. There, now it's bashing it against the wood. Dina, you're wondering if it's immune to the scorpion's sting. No, probably not. But that scorpion doesn't have a very strong sting at all. It uses its pincers for defense and for killing. And so I think what you'll find is because the poison gland at the back of the tail is actually quite small, you know, as long as the inside of the mouth isn't pierced by it, and there isn't an obvious injection of venom, I think it would be absolutely fine. So I think the stomach juices will digest the proteins of the poison. I mean, as far as I'm aware, you can basically, if you don't have a cut in your mouth, for example, you could ingest snake venom quite successfully, and your stomach muscles will break the proteins in the venom down. It's when it gets into the bloodstream that it's a problem. There we go. Delicious. Oh, look, there's the... Yeah, he ate the poison gland. I thought maybe he was going to just chop it off there. But he ate the whole thing, and now he's feeling very satisfied. How he got all of that into that small body, I don't know. So that bird is about, what should we say, about just shy of, say, 10 inches. So we'll give him 10 inches long. Now he's cleaning his teeth, sharpening his beak once more, and then it'll be back on the hunt. Well done, you clever bird. That's exactly what he's doing. You see he's cleaning his beak and sharpening it. It doesn't remain in that condition just because. You often see birds doing exactly what he's doing there. That was a fantastic sighting, I must say. Gee whiz. How proud he looks of himself. Hello, Gregory. You're asking a question about biofluorescence. Are some of the birds you say biofluorescent? I feel awful that I'm not entirely sure what you mean. Are you talking about something like phosphorescence, those animals that give off light? I think that's what you're talking about. The answer is no. No, they're not biofluorescent, as far as I'm aware. But a lot of them are iridescent, which means that their colours are reflected. Of, you know, they're very clever arrangements of melanin crystals in amongst air pockets and various pigments. But biofluorescence, I think, is restricted, I think, to fishes and things like phosphorescence in the ocean. Marvellous. That was excellent, wasn't it, Liam? Very good. Let's carry on. See if we can't find the queen doing the same thing with an impala. Here he goes. Right here. Look, look, look. Hello, James. A very good question about pellets and whether or not a kingfisher will produce pellets like an owl. Now, an owl, especially a barn owl, will produce pellets because it doesn't chew its food. It doesn't break its food up. It swallows mice, for example, whole. I'm going to say no, James. I don't think they do, because I think the chitin, once it's broken up, is probably digestible enough to be passed through the digestive system. With an owl pellet, somehow they've developed or evolved the digestive strategy where the hair, which is totally indigestible to all animals, and some of the bones, and I think you'll find the nails, probably the claws of the animal, and the teeth, are excluded from what goes through the digestive passage, and those are then spat out as pellets. As far as I know, and I don't know this for sure, only owls are able to do that, but I stand to correction on that. So I think that will expel any wastage immediately. Ah. Right, what a very good question. Thank you, Gregory. Great question. You say bioluminescence is what I was talking about with the fishes, where an animal is able to create, or like a glowworm or a firefly, an animal is able to create light from within. Whereas biofluorescence, which I should have realized actually, given that I know what fluorescence is when UV light shines on it, does it shine back off? No, I don't think I wouldn't say that they're fluorescent in the same way that other colours can be fluorescent. But I might be wrong there, Gregory. Thank you very much for that question. Those are, of course, the best kinds of questions, the ones that we don't really understand the answers to out here. And so, yes, perhaps a little bit more reading on biofluorescence is required from me. Thank you, Gregory. Great question there. Now, Steph seems to have managed to sort out his technical difficulties, and he's found himself a coleopterid.
So on the topic of biofluorescence and bioluminescence, I've got something to rival James's sighting in iridescence. Here we have an acacia. And these acacias this time of the year are covered in my favorite, one of my favorite orders of beetles, the Buprestidae, or the jewel beetles. And I've taken one off here to show you. These are tiny full-grown beetles, these ones. And these are most common at the moment on these acacias. And if the sun, which has been with us for the last half an hour now, decides to come and play again, you'll see that it goes from an iridescent green to a purple cover on the wings. And then I'll see if I can turn him over. There we go. There the sun comes out and plays. Isn't that just the most fantastic? And then goes to almost a brushed bronze color on the belly. Let's see if we can get that for you. Keep him turned. Sorry, I'm making it very difficult for Jean-André to keep him in frame here at full zoom. I'm being reprimanded with much raised eyebrows. These are just some of the most, one of the most collectible beetle orders in the world. Highly traded, dried, of course, and pinned in collections. Some of them trading for many thousands of dollars and euros. So it's a good thing that you don't know exactly where I'm standing, otherwise this tree would be worth something. Not that there's much of an insect trade that I know of, at least out of South Africa. It's far more common in, as you go closer to the equator in Africa. Obviously the insect load just gets much bigger there. But insects and eggs, funnily enough, are traded on the in world markets. Just beautiful, hey? John, have you been able to see some of the colors?
Yeah.
All right, we're gonna let this beetle go so that he can carry on with his day and we can carry on with ours. Here we go. Thank you very much for letting us see your beauty. Have a nice day. Right. We are walking around on a crest, and these crests are fantastic. They're fairly open, dominated by marula trees. Now, a marula tree is that big tree that you see over there. And in this particular crest, I must be honest with you, the marula trees almost grow right on top and only on top. You know that you're right on top when you see this line of marula trees, and it almost, you get up here and it almost feels like you've reached the top of a hill where you can look down on all sides around you. And the reason why they grow on these crests is because marulas really enjoy deep sandy soils. And this is the type of soil that the marula thrives in. This is what's left over from the base rock underneath these hills is granite, and it's a very rough grained granite. The granite itself is made up of particles just a little bit bigger than this, and it gives rise to this soil. It's quite a poor soil that leaches quite quickly, and it also doesn't hold a lot of water. But of course, for marulas, this is exactly the type of environment that they're looking for. So the marulas, and just off of the crest of the marulas, we start to get knob thorns. And I want to show you how perfect an example we have here. So there we have a marula tree, and a little bit downslope, we have the first knob thorn tree. And then everything downslope from there is knob thorn tree. From the knobthorn trees, you get a band of silver cluster leaf trees, which I'll try and show you when we get there. And below the silver cluster leaf trees, we get jackalberries and tambuertes and weeping boerbeans and all the riverine trees. And it's nice to see. This is it's a pristine environment where we're standing at the moment. Absolutely as it should be in this area. Nice example. Dale, you've just asked me if I get a bit frightened when everything gets green around me and we can't see what's around the corner. Dale, a trick here in the bush to staying alive is just to stay frightened, whether it's open or whether it's very green. it's a good idea just to stay terrified. That way, you're constantly looking for what's going to eat you behind the branches. But it does get a little bit trickier, I must be honest with you, as summer progresses. As you can see from just this vista that we have in front of us right here, these bush willow trees have a very large leaf, and when they start touching one another and the canopy becomes entire, or the bush becomes entire, then walks become a lot slower. We don't march through the bush, and you stop and listen quite often. We will move into a clearing like this, stop, and then you just look at and through the trees just to see what's through there, and that should keep you going for a long time. It's a trick that's worked for me at least for the last 18 or so years. I haven't been eaten much yet, although ticks do a good job of taking away some liters of blood per year, but all good. Watch out here, Jandre, don't fall over any of this stuff. What to do today? It's just such a beautiful day. There's quite a high wind blowing at the moment, and I don't quite know where it's blowing in or what it's blowing away, but before this flies away, off you go to Jamie.
Look, I think they may have found a nest. That is a female violet-backed starling, everybody. Look, they've got a tree hole nest there. I think they're investigating a nest there. The male is right behind her on the same tree, and he is, of course, the one with the actual violet back. She is not violet-backed at all. She is drab and, I suppose she's got quite a nice spotted plumage. But she's not quite as magnificent as him. Now, they are hole nesting birds. They are migratory. They've just arrived here. And this is clearly something that she thinks might be a neighborhood that they can raise a new family in. We'll just see if we can see him. He was in the same tree. Do you think he's still there, Vim? There he is. See the main fork of the tree? There, you got him there. Right a little bit, and a bit more, and down a bit, and he was there. There he is. He's not looking very magnificent there. He's hiding from us, preening himself while his wife does the furniture shopping. It's a little bit like a couple going furniture shopping where he sort of sits at the door, or perhaps goes to an eatery while his wife does the work of finding a home. Let's just go a little bit further forward and see if we can't see him, because he does look rather magnificent. She's back looking. Oh no, they've flown off now. That's very cool. We'll have to come back and check that nest hole, because I suspect that they might decide to use it. Now, we've come into the area around about where Karula was yesterday for the reason that there were alarm calls around the leopard, but not actually at her. So maybe Shongile and Hosana somewhere around here. We'll drive very slowly through this area and see if we can't find sign of them. And if we don't, I might just do a little bit of a walk through the drainage here and see if I don't pick them up there. That was really nice to see those birds. I seem to have picked up another friend. No, it's gone. It was a tree. Oh, I haven't noticed that one before. Well, we just sit up here and see if we don't hear any further alarm calls up in the top of the tree there. No, sorry, the main fork, Vimpy. A leopard orchid. There it is. And that's quite a new one. Now, I have been in Thailand, of course, for the last 10 days or so, and they have got orchids on all the trees there, and they're all different colours, and they actually start off looking very like that, that sort of cane-like structure of the leaves, and they look very similar, and then, of course, they turn into hundreds of different beautiful colours. Marvellous. On we go. And that one, of course,
It's 2 years next to each other.
Two leopard orchids next to each other. Viam's right. They're all over the place here. And then two more over that way. Yeah. So this is obviously a good leopard orchid place. What else did I want to say about them? Oh yes, of course, for those of you who don't know, if you are a new viewer, that's the only orchid species that we get in this particular area. And they make gorgeous yellow and brown spotted flowers, which is supposed to smell good, but I've never managed to get any kind of a scent out of one of them. And some of them are flowering now. But I'm afraid I have not found one sign of a leopard this morning. Alas and alack. But while I ponder the mysteries of where she is, let's head across to Jamie and get an update from her. I might do a little turn through here on foot and we'll catch up with you later.
Talk about that. Speaking of bird nests. Oh goodness, this is horrible. We are sitting at the moment with at Twin Dams, and sorry, I don't have any communications at all, which is interesting. In fact, it seems as though my earpiece has stopped working altogether. Sorry about that, everybody. We didn't realize that they were coming across to us. We're sitting at Twin Dams Dam with a hornbill. That's not a hornbill. It's called a hardy-dar. And the hardy-dars have a nest just in the jackalberry trees that line along the Mulwati drainage. And you can see him probing deep into the soft mud with a very sensitive bill, looking to see if he can catch things like freshwater snails that inhabit the mud around these water holes. Now, I've come across an interesting find, and I've been looking around to see exactly what is going on. I think I've found some cheetah tracks leading down towards the water's edge, and that's very unusual. We don't often see cheetah on Juma. There is one lone skittish male that we've seen once or twice. Oh, look at that. I don't envy that hardy-dar right in that water at the moment. There's a very strong wind. It must be very cold. And these are birds that are perfectly at home, both at the water's edge and in the surrounding areas. Their bills have incredibly sensitive nerve endings that will allow them to dig deep into the mud and pick up on any kind of minute movement, any scratching, any sign of life moving about. And all of these probing movements, not actually catching anything. If you look really closely, you'll see he's not coming up with any kind of, oopsie, fell down. Not coming up with any food, but it's just more like an exploratory probe into the mud to see whether or not, and if he does pick up on any kind of, he or she, if he does pick up on any kind of movement, then he will react by trying to get in deeper and grab whatever it is that it's looking for. You can see the entire car's rocking, you know, in this wind. You can actually feel Rusty moving. Imagine being a bird and how uncomfortable that must be as it lifts up your feathers. All in all, otherwise, Twin Dams is quiet. Brian, are you getting any talking from Final Control? Okay, so I'm not quite sure if that's... there we go. There we are. All sorted. All right. Maybe just go and see if I can figure out if this was a cheetah and where it has popped out. It's very difficult soil at the moment to see if it is a cheetah track. They're essentially the same size as a big male leopard's track. And a couple of defining features. One is the presence of the claws, of course, because adult cheetah have non-retractable claws. The little ones have semi-retractable claws, so they can sort of move their claws backwards and forwards. And the other aspect, just like all of the big cats, they do have three lobes at the back of their feet, but they're very sharp and angular. It's not nice and rounded in the same way leopards or lions might be. In cheetah, they are very, very sharp. We've been doing bird's nest this morning whilst looking for the big cats. And this is one over here, and I want to see if anybody's home or if it was a failed nest, because I haven't seen them recently. And let's just stop for a second. Oh. In the hole over there, Brian, in the dead silver cluster leaf, quite down, yeah, there we go. This was the crested barbet's nest. And we haven't seen any activity here since we saw the male excavating it, but we have seen the crested barbets moving about the area. And it makes me wonder whether or not perhaps there is anybody home. I don't want to go and stick my eye up against the hole, just in case there is somebody home. I don't think they'd be terribly impressed, and they'd probably get a big fright. I don't want to do that until we've established whether or not this nest is being used. And whether... I thought that was a crested barbet. It was not. I don't hear any of the trilling sounds that are typical of a crested barbet's call. So I think maybe after all of that, it might have been a nest hole that they decided actually they don't want to use. And that happens very commonly with many of the different nesting sites. Things like, you'll be familiar with the weavers, which we hardly ever see here, which is very odd. But you'll be familiar with the weavers that will make their nests. The male will go to all of the trouble of weaving the intricate nest, and the female will either tear it apart or just ignore it completely. Often the females are the ones responsible for choosing whether or not they want to lay their eggs in that particular spot. And it doesn't seem as though our crested barbet is home. Oh my goodness, it seems as though Steph is having an absolute ball on foot. Let's go see what he's found.
Today definitely seems to be the day of the lion. I think we've got another male lion in front of us here. Come with me. Definitely. So just next to that bush with a dark branch is the back of a male lion's head. This side? So that branch that you're looking at there is a male lion. Now that has to be one of the coalition, one of the Birmingham boys. This bush is just peppered with lions at the moment. It's incredible. Now, we're standing in the open, probably about 150 yards from him. The wind direction is not perfect, I'll be honest with you. But because it's blowing so hard, I don't think he's heard us. Now he's licking himself. Is he faced away from us or facing to us? Difficult to say. He's facing away from us. It's just incredible. We'll walk into lions here for months, and then all of a sudden in one day we get two. And now that is an absolute relaxed lion. You can see him busy licking himself. Completely unaware of us out here. With lions, you want to keep wind direction and cover as paramount. Now, we've got wind direction slightly on our side here. I use a ash sock, or sock filled with ash bag. And you can see the wind is blowing across from us. And so very good. In actual fact, it's much better than I thought it was going to be quite honest. Now with male lions, You want to give them space. What you don't want to do with a male lion that's angry with you is hide away. You want to stand in the open. So where we are standing right now, this is the safest place for us to be with a male lion on foot, especially at the distances that we're talking about right here. If you were to follow your gut instinct, for instance, and go and hide behind a bush, in other words, go and hide behind there, and this male lion was trying to chase us away, there's every expectation that he would come right up into these bushes. They like to use cover to come at you. In this particular instance, he's in the open, we're in the open, and there's not much cover between us and him. We couldn't be safer from where we are now. Relatively speaking, we are, of course, standing 150 yards from a big male lion. Now, I think let's get onto the Game Drive channel again and see if we can call whoever wants to come and have a view of this particular male lion in here. It's a fairly thick block, but I'm sure we'd be able to get them in along the same crest we've been following. Along the same crest we've been following. And I think what we're going to do while we get onto these Game Drive comms or communications, as we call it, these handhelds, and find out who's in this particular area, we're going to send you over to James and we'll get you back when somebody else is around.
Well, Steph and Aubrey seem to be on fire, everybody, which is wonderful. I'm not going to go to their male lion. I think it's great that they found it on foot, but I think we've had some good male lion stuff. What we're looking at here is Karula's favorite tree, in which I've seen her twice. That's why I say it's her favorite tree. And we just came down here to see if we couldn't perhaps find any further tracks. We have not found any further tracks at this stage. So we'll pop down to Treehouse Dam and then make a plan from there. A driving wind now from the southeast. But no further sign of any cat. Well, that's all right. Also, interestingly, since I have been here, or since I left and came back, the elephants have disappeared. Now, we all knew that was going to happen. We knew that they were going to disperse as soon as the sort of weather started to improve, as the rain started to improve. And unfortunately, it's no longer the case that you drive around a bush and there is always some kind of elephant sitting there. Sorry, Steph is now hailing me on the Game Drive channel. Go ahead. Steph's just telling me about the lion you've just seen with him. Copy. Steffi, we're not going to make our way there, if that's right. I think we're probably lioned out at the moment. I think we've had two very nice male lion sightings. Jamie's quite close to that area, so I think she's going to make her way there now. Hang on a second. Oh, that's a lovely sound, isn't it, VM? I found some tracks of something. I think, however, they are... I don't know what they are, actually. They're fairly unclear. They are definitely not of an antelope. I would suggest, however, that they are of a civet. There is one civet going this way, then it has turned around. There are also some monkey tracks going around that way. Not a leopard at this stage. Now, please remember that we do love to talk to you. Hashtag Safari Live, questions at wildearth.tv if you're on the email. Those are the two best ways to get hold of us. You can ask us anything you like about Africa. You can ask us about traveling this great continent. You could ask us about the animals. You can ask us about anything else you want to about here, and or anything biological, in fact, at all. Tell us about the wildlife where you are and compare it with the wildlife where we are here. I always enjoy those discussions as well, especially on a day like today when, well, we've had some nice sightings, but it hasn't been sort of high action. Now, the watering hole of Treehouse Dam is just down the road here. Let's see if we can't find something there. I must say it is very windy indeed, which is not great for tracking things. I'm also hoping fairly soon to see some wildebeest calves. Wildebeest calves are something of a premium in this area. And apparently there have been one or two born. Rebecca says 2 days ago the first wildebeest calves were spotted. So that was right at the end of November. Can also somebody please tell me what date it was that the woodland kingfisher came home? Because it was after last year. Last year was the 16th of November. And this year was the... Rebecca's mind is ticking over frantically in the final control, I can tell. Jerry is now typing frantically. There's a lot of umming and ahhing. Come on, Jerry. So we think it was the 22nd of November. So that was a full week after it came back last year. I wonder why. So interesting. And nobody got it right. That's interesting. I think we all thought that they came back late last year because of the drought. And so I think everybody thought that they'd come back a little bit earlier than they did this year. Who was closest? I think I may have been closest. Thank you, Karen Kirsten. You say the 21st and the 23rd. No, Rebecca, I'm afraid you can only have one first sighting. It was either the 21st or the 23rd. It's a bit like unique or being dead. Ah! Right, there we go. Right, so Kirsten said the 21st and Karen said the 23rd. They were both the closest because apparently it was the 22nd. There we go. I've got it sorted out now. Right, while I have now completely befuddled my mind, I'm going to sit here, contemplate life briefly. Jamie has got a highly mobile chelonid.
That sounds like a very nice plan for James this morning, to spend it contemplating life. While James contemplates life, we are contemplating the biggest Speke's hinge tortoise that I have ever seen. This is probably about as large as you will ever see a Speke's hinge tortoise get, and I'm going to give you a sense of scale in a moment. I am, by the way, on my way towards Steph and that lion, so we are going to be making our way in that direction. I said I'd contact him when I was a bit closer to that area, but I just want to give you a sense of scale. Now, typically we do get very large leopard tortoises, but at the moment, they're the biggest tortoise that we see. But the Speke's that we're looking at here, hello buddy, you're very hidden, is absolutely massive. This is most definitely by far the biggest Speke's hinge tortoise I've ever seen. Do you mind, buddy, if I just... No, I can't lift that up without disturbing him and without lifting him up as well. And you'll have to take my word for it that he is absolutely massive. Brian, I suppose you've got quite a poor view there. Yeah, unfortunately, it's okay. It's all right. He appears to have beached himself on a log. It's such fun watching them move about. The hinge of the Speke's hinge tortoise actually sits at the back. So whenever they retract themselves into their shell, when there is danger, there is a hinge that runs along the middle of their back, or just below the middle of their back, and allows them to pull down the hinge towards the lower part, so the plastron of their shell, and cover up their tail and their back feet. to one of their most vulnerable sides. Sorry, buddy. All right, you keep going. Since he doesn't seem to want to carry on moving forward and he doesn't seem to want to give us a good view, we'll carry on towards Steph and those lions instead. We've been so spoiled with tortoise sightings. Brian, we had a tortoise the other day that was this big. It was so cute. It was absolutely wonderful and walked straight over my hands just to give a really nice perspective of scale. It can't have been much older than a year. Right. Let's start heading in Steph's direction. He did calmly and somewhat laconically say on the game drive radio that he wasn't going to be sticking around with the mail line, which is fair enough. Someone's on foot. You can very easily overstay your welcome. They are happy, they're happy to be seen at a distance and they're comfortable with you. And they'll be perfectly relaxed, but if you stay for a long period of time watching them, they start to get edgy and uncomfortable, especially if you're whispering, which is something we've spoken about before. That whisper often puts them on edge because they feel as though you're trying to sneak up on them. But of all of the, I suppose it's the same for all animals, but particularly with lions, you can really overstay your welcome. And they make it very clear. They either get up and they move away, or they start to growl at you. Which is fair enough. Just letting you know, and it's very, very kind of them to give us those warning signs, just to let us know that they are in fact aware of us and they'd really rather prefer that we weren't around. Now we'll go and join them in the vehicle instead. I'm just checking carefully before I go racing off to those lions and miss tracks for Karula. I just want to check something quickly. I don't know where I saw it now. No. False alarm. False alarm. It was antelope feet. A couple of different antelope landing on top of each other, trying to create leopard tracks to fool us. I'm still bemused by those cheetah tracks, and I'm still not 100% sure that they were cheetah tracks. If they were, though, they were heading straight to our boundary, straight towards our southern boundary. So there's a very good chance that that animal is not. I've checked our southern boundary now. It doesn't look as though that animal, the cheetah, if it was a cheetah, is still on Juma. Okay. Well, from what I could understand, from what Steph told me, let's just check for Karula quickly. Not go too fast and drive past her. I'm fascinated to know which tree James calls Karula's favorite tree. I wonder if we have the same idea in our head as to which one it is. Because I don't know that I could choose which of Karula's trees is her favorite. I have a sort of narrow list, but I'm not sure which one would be, I would consider to be her absolute favorite. Aha. Sorry, that was my fault. There we go. That improves things. Now let's go over to Steph with his lions on foot.
Unbelievably, we've still got this male lion completely and blissfully unaware of our presence. And we have had a response on the radio from Jamie. She is making her way here. She got sidetracked a little bit by a tortoise, I'm told, but it's okay. This lion hasn't seen us yet, and so it's not too much of a problem, as much as that sounds. We're constantly still checking wind direction. The wind is still blowing diagonally across from both of us, so there's no way that unless he looks up at the right moment and we just make a small shift that he'll see us. But he's facing away from us. He's restless. He's not calm. He constantly stares at that mating pair in the direction that that mating pair is lying. And I almost think that these male lions are probably in some or other type of subtle dominance display with one another. You probably find that that's what's going on. It's just this scent of estrus is in the air and it's become irresistible. And rather than patrolling their territory, they're just patrolling the females. And that's why he's just not settled. cleaning himself, lying there, staring into the distance. He's not lying down like you'd expect a male lion to be this time of the day already. He's busy cleaning his paws now. You can see the dipping of the head as he licks. So yeah, just to get back into a discussion, which I think is vitally important to have whenever we're on foot with animals like this. It's our goal and our aim not to bother these animals whatsoever, or to have as little impact on these animals as we can. Lions are incredibly sensitive to the environment, and they're almost a perfect gauge as to how close or far, or what your bush skills actually are like. Lions that jump away from you and run away panicked, you've made a mistake somewhere as a person approaching those animals. Either the wind direction is wrong, or you didn't notice what was the signs and the little telltales around the bush, or you weren't keeping your head up enough. But ideally, we don't want these animals to see us on foot. As little interaction as possible with us observing them as much as we can. But also, my point is the fact that these lions can live in harmony with people. They're not just the killers that we all think they are. And that if you have respect and you have proper skill, humans and lions can absolutely coexist in harmony. I just find it a wonderful grounding moment being in close proximity to lions like this. According to Jandre's camera, we are 75 yards away from that male lion. So half the distance I thought we were at, which is a bit worrying, but anyway, at least a little bit closer than further away. Now, I'm told while we're waiting for Jamie that James has also bumped into something that we infrequently see here at Juma. So we'll catch up with you in a little bit.
This is exactly what I was doing yesterday, everybody. I was eating on the snow white berry bush. And that's what that baboon is doing. Now, we don't often get great baboon sightings. There, she's taken a snack with her. And now, I don't know how many of you have seen this, but that distended, swollen, fairly unattractive looking backside is to a male baboon deeply, deeply attractive. So she is in heat, clearly. She's ready to breed. Now I'm going to sneak forward. There's a whole troop of them all around us, but they're very nervous of us, which is very sad, I think, because they're such fun to watch. There she goes, just to the right-hand side there. I'll try and get into a slightly better position. There we go. You see her there, Vimpy? There she is. Oh, they really just don't like to sit with us. But you can see there the swollen sort of bottom back end there, which, well, I mean, if you're not used to looking at it, can be quite frightening. Now, have you got a few more there? Oh, hang on, let's quickly go back to Steph.
This male lion's actually just stood up right now, and it's definitely the male lion with the injured foot. He's now coming a little bit closer to us. So what I want to do is just back up into an openish area. So Jandre, we can back up a little bit. I just want to give space. Looks like he's laying down there actually. He was looking for some shade. He hasn't come out from behind that bush. Okay, so Jandre saw with the aid of the camera, or you would have seen with the aid of the camera, that he's now laying down in the shade there, which is actually okay. So he still doesn't know we're here. Definitely can confirm it's a male lion with a big limp. I'm not actually sure which one it is. I don't see these animals all that often. With me being on foot, I don't get to spend as much time with these lions as I should. But I'm told that it's probably Tino that's got that big limp on one of his front legs. I hope that isn't too bad. They break their legs quite often, to be quite honest. Their little bones, they bite each other's legs. And so it's not uncommon to get a thorn, a porcupine quill, an injury from that was a Franklin just having a bit of a panic. And what we've got to watch out for that is displacement sort of observation. That male lion looking up at the Franklin, all of a sudden seeing us and getting a fright. It doesn't look like he's done anything there. Still just lying down below there. I'm just going to see, Jamie is now close, and see if we can get Jamie in here. Jamie, Steph, when you get to the crest of those marulas, past the Hyena Road Junction or Central, just let me know.
Copy that, Steph. I'm here. I'm just standing by on the crest on the on Central Road.
Okay, copy. Then drive west in the Maroolas, in the Maroola belt. Just drive west towards the drainage line.
Okay, copy.
So we've got Jamie now on the radio. She's probably about 100 yards or so away from us. Now it becomes a triangulation mission. I'm trying to vector in Jamie to where we're standing, keeping an eye on the line to make sure he doesn't move away, while trying to figure out which road is closest to us, because we're standing right in the middle of a block between roads here. So it becomes an issue to do with basically just intuition, really, than anything else. I've asked Jamie to come down a line of marula trees. I'm hoping she's got the same marulas that I have, towards a drainage line. There's many drainage lines here. Perhaps Jamie doesn't know which one. And then obviously using compass bearings, that's west where the sun sets. So she was east of us. She needs to come west of where we are now. And then hopefully we'll be able to put you onto Jamie's car and you can go and have a closer look and perhaps see what's wrong with his leg. He hasn't moved there at all. Copy that. Jamie, I think come west off of the road towards Twin Dams Road, not towards Buffalo Cutline.
Okay, copy.
All right, so we've, like I say, it becomes a bit of a mission in triangulation to try and get everybody in here, and at the same time, keeping your eye open to see that you aren't being snuck upon by anything else. We've been on foot now in very close, relatively speaking, proximity to this lion for probably 20, 25 minutes. I personally feel that the only reason why we've done that is because he's distracted by that mating pair, and we've got this really strong wind pushing between the two of us over here. I think if it was in any other circumstance, that male lion would have heard us already. Something in the bush would have alerted them. They have these abilities to sense things, changes in the bush around them. I would say that male lion probably and crocodile have about the biggest sort of peripheral sense and feeling about the bush around them. So I think we're in luck. Now, I'm going to send you over to James so that Jamie and I can chat on this thing. We'll catch up with you in a little bit.
Now, we've left the baboons, I'm afraid. Well, more accurately, they left us. So now we've come down here, where apparently yesterday there was a dead impala lamb, we think stillborn, and there was a young male leopard lurking around here that then ran off and hadn't returned by the afternoon. So we're just going to drive down and see if there isn't something else going on here this morning. We're just not quite sure exactly where it was, somewhere around here. There's a steerenbok on the road. No, now it's run away, obviously. Seems to be a lot of running away at the moment, which is very irritating. Anyway, we'll see what we can find. Steph has obviously had quite a day today. I guess that's wonderful. I'm a bit jealous, to be honest. Anyway, we will keep our search up. There goes the aerial. Viam, any idea from here? He'll let me know if he sees it, he says, everybody. That's very helpful. Okay, good. Okay, thank you very much for that. He says if we hit Twin Dams, the water, then we've gone too far. Anyway, we'll find something else through here, I'm sure. You're pointing now, are you? Yes? Yes, looks familiar. Good, yes. Might be, but might just be a similar area. Okay, well, I think we've just gone past a drongo's nest in this tree here. There are so many hole nesting birds, and so holes in trees, of course, are of a premium. I think maybe in that nest, in that tree. Anyway, we've missed it. Let's carry on. Over that little bump. On we go. What is that over there? Buffalo. Is it? Is it? Could it really be a buffalo? Yes. I believe it to be a buffalo. Through the thickest thicket on the reserve. Oh, this is frustrating. Can you see it there, VM? It's a sort of black shadow. You think it's waterbuck? No, no, can't be. No, there's definitely a buffalo in there. Hang on a second. Can you see it? Is it a buffalo?
Yeah, it's waterbuck.
Yeah. Can't be.
If we go back, I'll tell you.
Yeah, maybe everybody will find out. Maybe you can tell us what you think it is. You've got it. I can see the waterbuck, but that's not what I saw. I assure you, there's something large and black through here. Maybe it's a very dark waterbuck. Steph finding lions all over the place. I can't identify whether I'm looking at a buffalo or not. No, it's a nyala. It's not a buffalo, and its visual is 1 out of 5. Let us continue. Absolutely hopeless. Right, come on. Liam, I would like you now to tell me where this impala was. We're now going to cross a road. Is that good? Oh, all right. Well, we'll carry on then. We'll keep going down here. I think there is an open area down through here. So keep an eye out, everybody, for a young male leopard. Here's some off-road tracks. Should we go in there? Oh, there's an impala. Oh, you think this is the mother? Oh, shame. Basically, where that female standing apparently is where the youngster was. There she is. Let's just stop here and have a little bit of a listen. Oh, shame. She does look like she's looking for something that isn't there. But somewhere around here was the dead fetus. Anyway, that's a bit macabre, but I was rather hoping there might be a leopard with the youngster in a tree somewhere here, but clearly there's no leopard on the ground there. You think it was under there? Right, let's carry on. No, Gail, what a nice question from you, but the answer is an absolutely and categorical no, Dale. You say, will they like a leopard or a lion? If they lose a youngster, will that sort of promote them coming into estrus again quickly? The answer is no. They are seasonal breeders, which means they come into estrus not born of whether they have young or not, but born of whether, or it's actually a day length thing for them, and it pushes them into estrus. And also the action of the males when they fight, and they fight, their testosterone levels are dependent on the day length. So interestingly, no, it will have no effect on them coming into estrus whether or not they lose their youngsters. No, I don't see any young male leopards here. I do, however, see a beautiful morning glory flower, which of course is not going to go anywhere, so I think we will definitely have a look at it. Can you see it there, Via? Oh, wonderful. Super zoom. It's behind a tree, obviously. Yeah, you know, sometimes you have the luck and sometimes you don't. On we go. Right, mercifully Jamie has managed to find the lion that Steph found, so let's go and have a look at that while I bumble through here cluelessly.
I think we owe Steph all of the credit for that particular spot. And here is the mail line that Steph was with a few moments earlier on foot, hiding out in the shade of a buffalo thorn, looking thoroughly content and really rather beautiful on this morning. The sun slowly starting to come up, the temperature heating up. At first glance, it looks as though it might be Tinio. I'm just waiting for him to relax a little bit because obviously he was aware of Steph on foot and the rest of the bushwalk team. So he's been watching and glancing across in their direction. So I don't want him to feel pressured in any way with a vehicle on one side and perhaps the bushwalk team walking away on the other. So we're just going to settle for now with this particular view. And then, yeah, the fact that he's turning his head suggests that he is a great deal more comfortable. When I first arrived, he was doing the head bob that all cats do when they first see you. And dogs don't do it, cats do. It's that sort of trying to get a different view. I don't know how to describe it. Very rapid head movement from side to side and up and down. Just trying to get a good fix on whatever's moving. Now, he knew there were people there, but he wasn't quite sure exactly where they were, and he just wants to make sure that they weren't trying to creep up on him. He has found his very comfortable spot for the morning. Hello, boy. Just want to see if he's going to do the head bob again. But I think that Steph and the rest of the bushwalk team are already on their way out. Still glancing in their direction, head's not completely down, so he's alert and aware of what's happening. I was hoping, not that it wouldn't be lovely to see Tinio, and I'll have to get a little bit closer to confirm that it is him, but I was hoping that we might have a chance to see Nsugo or Nena, the two Birmingham boys that we hardly ever get to see. Hi, boy. It's okay. They're gone. I promise, they're on their way. It's amazing. We always talk about how animals' eyesight is not particularly good. It's not bad at all. And they're very geared towards movement. Any kind of motion immediately attracts their attention. So whilst it might not be as strong as their sense of hearing or their sense of smell, they can see better than I think sometimes we give them credit for. The only exception to that being Rhino. Rhino cannot see very well at all. And buffalo are not fantastic either. They're sort of always blinking at you myopically, trying to work out what you're up to. I'm going to wait until he's stopped glancing in that direction. I'm sure that's where bushwalk team is moving off to. I'm just going to wait until we have a chance to reposition once he's relaxed a little bit more. Okay. I take that back. His eyes are closing. So I think that's our cue to go and get a slightly better view. Oh, hold on. Here we go, Rusty. Last time I saw Tinio, he was limping a little bit, and he had a puncture wound on his face. Hello, boy. Here we go. It's all right. It's okay. You can see that slight lift to his lip that immediately tells us that it is, in fact, Tinio. Here we go. There we go, boy. Oops, sorry, that was my fault. It was not Brian's camera work, that was entirely my fault. Hello, boy. There we go. Now we're a bit more relaxed. Now, the puncture wound was on the left side of his face, and it was bleeding a little bit, weeping a little bit, and he was rubbing it constantly with his paw. It doesn't seem to be too much of a problem anymore. I can't see. Oh, there's a little bit of fresh blood there. So it might still be open. And they do often keep their own wounds open. They sort of, there we go, that's it. They rub at them with their paws and worry at them because, of course, it's discomforting for them. And they can't help but try and relieve some of that discomfort by rubbing up against it with their feet. Now, this is probably the way that Mfumo's injury started. just a little puncture wound that he just got unlucky and it turned into a really nasty infection or cyst, which then came complete with maggots at one point. It's okay, boy. They're gone. He's still relatively relaxed. He's still completely relaxed. He's just alert and aware of what's going on around him. Hopefully we have a chance to see before the end of the sunrise safari whether or not his walk is any better. And a very good morning to Michael, who wants to know, because of course we spoke earlier about the nutritional dystrophy that occurred within the Nkuhumas. Michael, you want to know why is it, well, if they weren't getting the nutrition that they needed from the buffalo, why is it that they weren't varying their diet? It's an interesting one because it depends on the number of lions. Male lions often target buffalo because of their size, so it's a good meal for them. Whereas the females are targeting the buffalo because there's five of them plus eight, well, now six little cubs. So that's why they were targeting buffalo. They were also, yes, you're absolutely right, they were easy to catch because they're very thin and very weak. Sorry, very bright sun this morning. So they're quite thin and quite weak, which makes them easy for the lions to catch. And there are quite a few of them. The buffalo was sort of concentrated in an area, whereas the other animals have been slightly more spread out. Stay hat. The buffalo have been moving about quite a lot in big groups together around waterholes. So it's been easy for the lions, and that's why they've been targeting them. It's also generally those are the, particularly with the size of the animals or the number of animals that we've been seeing, and particularly with the boys hanging out with the ladies as they have been. It's only recently that has stopped. It could also be that we're not seeing the smaller meals, although I don't think so. I just don't think that the lions have been eating anything else besides buffalo. But as I said at the start of the sunrise safari, they might have eaten an entire zebra last night and we wouldn't have known. We wouldn't have been able to tell, because it would just be gone before we'd even had a chance to find it. And the only way we'd ever become aware of it is if we happened to encounter that carcass on foot. So it's possible they are targeting other prey items, and it's just because the buffalo are big that we're finding them. But I think it's more likely just that it's easier, and because there's lots of mouths to feed, it makes sense for them not to waste energy chasing something that is not going to be enough food for all of them. Now, speaking of things that might not be sufficient to feed as many lions as we've seen this morning, let's go see which antelope Steph has found.
I hope you've been enjoying that lion. That is lion food there. Just looking at a female waterbuck moving out of the picture there for you behind those bushes. She's with some impala. Just seems like today we're walking into all the big stuff. Real nice selection of different things that we're walking into. Quite nice, eh? I hope you've been enjoying that male lion. Do you know yet what's wrong with its leg? I don't know yet. I haven't heard anything. We'll chat about it over breakfast. I'm sure it's going to be one of those lovely chats. Now, we're standing in an area here that is just, for me, one of the prettiest places in the whole of Juma. It's in a dip, and it's in a depression. We battle a little bit with signal here from time to time, which is why we're not going to move around too much. But you can have a look at some of the giant trees that we have here. We've got a jackalberry tree, not the biggest one. I'm going to show you a much bigger one now. Coming from left, from right to left, the dead trees that you're seeing are all drought-damaged leadwoods. Some peppered with some knobthorns. Coming back across there, we've got another large leadwood tree growing just on the other side of that termite mound. We've got some giant knobthorn trees on the skyline over there. And then, of course, the granddaddy. Ooh, I was going to bend down under the camera there. You caught me with a little trick. We've got the granddaddy of all jackalberry trees there. That is easily a 25 meter or 25, 30 yard tree. One of the biggest ones, one of the biggest trees that we have at Juma. And you can see the wind absolutely powering through the foliage there. And like I said, last night we had a lovely thunderstorm again at about 10 o'clock. It was just so beautiful to be around. camp dust flying, noisy, you know, that usual chaos that goes with a thunder shower. It was fantastic. And we woke up this morning, there was this band of dark clouds on the horizon. That seems to have, in the course of the morning, blown away. But you can see from this cloud that's up here now, that this column of air that's blowing the wind extends quite high up. And those clouds, I don't know, they look to me like they can bring some rain again this afternoon. I'm hoping for it. They're coming from the right direction. We get rain from the south, southwest, southeast, mainly from the southeast. And this is blowing straight out of that particular direction. So it's going to be nice to see what happens this afternoon. What actually is going to go on this afternoon? If it's going to be cloudy or it's going to be clear. Anyway, I'm going to send you over to James. He's got a squirrel to show you.
Indeed, a squirrel, everybody, sitting at what I think is probably his favourite sunning spot on this little marula tree. But he's not alone, is he, Viam? Oh, no. Just above him is a magnificent blue-headed tree agama. How wonderful is that little animal? It is a lizard that is almost a foot long, I would say. And that's the male. He has a beautiful blue head and a bit of green on it and yellow down the spine. You can see there a bit of orange in the backside. The female, pretty much the same colour as his tail. Isn't he lovely? And he'll be looking for invertebrates to eat. That'll be basically his diet, as far as I can remember. Let me just quickly actually get my book out and make sure that I'm not talking nonsense. And as far as I remember we were asked a little while back, can they lose their tails? And I didn't know the answer, and a very kind viewer told me that no, they cannot lose their tails. There we go, blah blah. Feeds mainly on insects, that was correct. Ultramarine, that's a lovely way to describe the colour of that head, isn't it? Ultramarine. That's exactly what it is. And the female takes on the colour almost exactly of the tree, and often of lichens that grow on the trees. Vim, can we go back down to the squirrel, which seems to have gone into the hole? There we are. It's obviously where it lives. Isn't that sweet? Now, I'd love to know from you, I'm sure many of you are as scandalized and terrified by rats as the rest of us are, but this thing, this squirrel, everybody thinks is so cute, you know, but they're from the same order. They are rodents. And yet a rat is something terrifying, whereas a squirrel is something cute and cuddly. You go quite a long way to find a soft toy that is made in the form of a rat, but squirrels you will find many of. It is a glorified rat, that's correct, Viam, with a bushy tail. A bushy-tailed and glorified rat. Very good ears for hearing, of course. Excellent climber and a hoarder of nuts. That's wonderful. How cool is that? Let's just have quickly another look there at the agama. Fuzzman Sparkles, you're wondering if they're related to the bearded watties? Dragons, bearded dragons of Australia. I've got no idea, Fuzzman Sparkles. I'm going to suggest probably not closely. Now, the reptiles, of course, they used to roam the earth many hundreds of millions of years ago as the dinosaurs, and that was when Pangaea, I think, was still around, or perhaps the successors of Pangaea. In other words, when the continents were closer to each other, and they then split apart. And what I think you'll find, therefore, is that there have been so many hundreds of millions of years that animals like this have been separated from their common ancestral cousins, if you like, that I'm going to say not very closely related to the bearded dragon of Australia because of the geographical separation. So yes, I'm sure they are related in so much as they're reptiles, but I don't think they'd be anything like as closely related, say, as... what kind of mammal example can I give you? I think probably, yeah, as exactly, as probably less closely related than the squirrel is to the rat. The squirrel is now scandalized at being described like a rat. Now, Forrest, you're a new viewer and wondering what kind of squirrel that is and what kind of squirrels we get in Africa. Well, this one is called a tree squirrel, Forrest, and it's the only one that we get here. And interestingly, you do get something called a red forest squirrel. Forrest, you like that? We also get the European grey squirrel, which is found in Cape Town. And much like most things in Cape Town, it is an exotic and should be purged from the land. And then in this... The other wonderful squirrel we get in South Africa is the ground squirrel. And I'll just find you all the rest of the squirrels quickly. And the ground squirrel live in the deserts and they live in burrows with very thick sort of parasol-like tails. Vim, you're doing a sterling job there. But in Africa, Forrest, we get many, many different kinds of squirrels. In fact, I'm just trying to sort of count them now. I'll show you the pictures of them once we've finished looking at this rather magnificent fellow. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, you can hear me counting. About 40 different species of squirrel throughout Africa. Very few in this part of the world, though. Most of them will be found forest, unsurprisingly, in the forests of Central Africa. And I'll just quickly show you the pictures of them. There they all are there. That's an interesting thing called a Rwenzori sun squirrel that's found up on the Nile. It's interesting. Anyway, there's a whole lot of them there. There are a whole lot more over there. None of these that are found here. They're all found in West Africa in the forests. All of those also there. And there we go. Also, same thing. There's some more also found generally in East Africa. Then we get these ones are found in the bush. So the bush would be sort of around the savanna areas. And then I'll just try and find you the ground squirrel. Smith's bush squirrel, they say, that's obviously the one that they say we've got here, and that's the tree squirrel there. And where did I want to find the South African ground squirrel? That's the one there. That's it there. And you can see it's got that very thick tail that it uses as a parasol. So it flops it over its head in the desert during the sun, and that's how it finds shade all day long. Many, many different kinds of squirrels. Righty, on we go. Jonathan, you made some sort of comment about them being so popular because of their tales or because of tales told of them. What was it? No. Oh, because of their fluffy tails. Right, Jonathan, yes, I suppose I think that probably is exactly what it is, because a rat, of course, well, apart from being a vector of horrible disease, has that rather sort of intimidating, snake-like, naked tail, which does give it a kind of shuddery appearance. That was an excellent squirrel sighting. Well done, Vian. And blue-headed tree agama. Making one last turn past Treehouse Dam, and then I think we shall turn for home and our bacon and eggs. Yum. You looking forward to that, Vim?
Sorry, I was going to say.
You looking forward to bacon and eggs?
Yes, always.
Well, Steph, of course, is on foot. He will be very hungry after the exercise he's been doing. Let's go and find out what he's going to do for the last few moments of the drive.
I'm not that hungry, but thanks for thinking of me, James. Now, with today's bumping into lion and going here and going there and going everywhere, we've been walking around in circles, and quite easily you can get lost out here if you don't keep your bearings about you. Now, for those of you who were with us when we found those male lions on foot just now, or that male lion on foot just now that Jamie is having a look at, you noticed that we used the radio, and that's one way of doing it. Of course, if you know where you are, you'll see me telling Jamie, come west of the road, we're slightly north of this junction. But what happens if you don't have a radio? What happens if you don't have a compass? What happens if you need to rely on some environmental indicators around you? Now, one of the ways that we do that out here is interestingly using dung, particularly from the dwarf mongoose. And here we have a termitarium that is evidently being used by a colony of dwarf mongoose by the latrine area that they have over here. Now, dwarf mongoose colonies in South Africa, south of the Tropic of Capricorn, almost always have their latrine on the northern side of the Termite Mound. The reason for that is quite simple. Dwarf mongoose are quite, how do I say, they like the leisure, they like lives of leisure, and they find sunbathing in the morning preferable to finding food or foraging for food. And quite often, just off of these sunbathing areas, they will have a latrine spot. And in this particular case, north, and I'm going to draw it for you as far as I can gather. Let me just get my bearings where we are. There's east, east-west, north-south. So this is north, where we are now. And you can see when you look at the Termite Mound in total, you'll see that it is on the northern side of the Termite Mound. Interesting, hey? Other animal indicators that you can use similarly are the red-billed buffalo weaver nests quite often, and this needs to be taken as a percentage of the buffalo weaver nests in an area. But the higher percentage of nests will be built on the northern side of the tree. Similarly, for this, as the dwarf mongoose, is that it in the northern or in the southern hemisphere, it is the warmest slope during winter, and of course that's where you want to be. You want to be on the warm side during winter, and that's why it is on the northern side. You could use moss as well. I haven't really had much luck with moss, but they say that moss will now, as opposed to this, grow on the shadow side of the tree, so on the cooler side of the tree. In this particular case, it would be on the southern side of the tree. What else could we use to tell direction? I'm just trying to rack my brain now to try and see, other than, of course, a GPS and anything else that we could use. But no, I think let's just, in summary, finish it there. I don't want to rack my brain too much. You're going to watch my eyes go all cross-eyed and my ears start glowing red. So just, this again is a dwarf mongoose latrine. In this area, south of the Tropic of Capricorn, we have these latrines generally on the northern side of the Termite Mounds. And walking around in an area like this will give you a good idea of basic direction if you ever get stuck out here at Juma and you have dwarf mongoose around. Come with me. It's been a fantastic day today, I must be honest with you. It's just one of those days. We just walked into lions today. You go months here without walking into a lion, and then all of a sudden, doesn't matter where you turn, there's a lion waiting for you. Some daddy long legs here. So these spiders are I'm losing my voice today. My Rebecca is not the only one today that's getting tongue-tied. You can see that daddy long legs swinging around in a circle over there. That is a characteristic of the daddy long leg spider, is that bouncing circular motion that they make when they get disturbed. All right, and that brings us to the end of the bushwalk for this morning's sunrise safari. I just want to say thank you very, very much for joining us this morning. Myself and Jandre have had a lot of fun walking into all the lions, and it's a good thing that we got to show them to you as well. So I hope you got some nice photos. And once again, thank you for all your support, questions, etc., etc. We'll see you soon again on a walk, wherever you are in the world. Enjoy your day.
Well, we're doing one more little turn around quarantine. And Ellen, while we, just before we hand you back to Jamie for the last few minutes of the drive, you want to know if humans in this area hunt squirrels and eat them. Yes, they do, from time to time. I've never eaten a squirrel here. Have you eaten a squirrel? VM's looking confused, so he may have eaten a squirrel, but I don't think so. Look, we all eat Vienna sausages, don't we? Yeah, so we may have eaten them. Exactly, yeah. McDonald's, for example, could easily put squirrels in their Big Macs here. But no, I haven't eaten them, but yes, they are edible, but I mean, they're tiny, you know, they're so small that they've got almost no meat on them at all. But I'm sure the youngsters out here who are on school holidays and looking for a meal, because of course there is huge poverty out here, they will almost certainly go and try and hunt squirrels and eat them. So yes. Right, everyone, that's going to be it from the Jigger today. The Jigger, of course, is this fine vehicle that we've been driving on today. Thank you, VM, for your efforts. Yes. Give us a quick flash thumb, will you? There, very nice. Excellent. And we'll hand you back to Jamie for the rest of the drive. Thanks for coming with us, and we'll see you this afternoon.
And what a fantastic lion-filled morning this has been. Three separate lion sightings throughout the day. An exciting way to enjoy another bright sunny morning out here in Africa. And I'm sure you're all thrilled to have James and his quirky sense of humour, and Brian actually and his quirky sense of humour, back on our vehicles once again. Tinio did get up and move, and he moved himself into a more dense area after he'd established that the bushwalk team were well and truly gone. And he's still limping. It's nothing serious, but he is still limping. It's uncomfortable. Hopefully that will heal up in the future. Sometimes dominant male lions have limps for the rest of their lives, and it's just something that happens with them. There might be something that is damaged in the joint. Chances are, though, he is going to heal up, just in the same way that the scar on the top of his lip has all but disappeared. But he's feeling a little sorry for himself this morning. Mfumo got the girl. He's got a whole load of bite wounds all over his legs and his face. He doesn't look as though he's had a meal recently. All in all, he's feeling a little bit... Well, I'm saying he looks a little bit miserable. Might not be the case at all. He might actually be glad of the reprieve of lion and lion cubs and company. He might just be quite happy to be where he is, resting off in the shade. And it does mean some exciting prospects for this afternoon's sunset safari. They have found one of the other Birmingham boys on Cheetah Plains, which by process of elimination could only mean that it is Nena on Sugu, who will be trundling along in that direction this afternoon to see whether or not we can't catch up with them and maybe go off in search of more baby wildebeest as well. Since the wildebeest on Juma seem to be absent, I think it'd be quite nice to go and look for more signs of summer on Cheetah Plains. But unfortunately, as quick as a flash or Flash Gordon, it seems as though the morning sunrise safari has come to its natural conclusion, and we'll be heading home to enjoy some of Amanda's amazing breakfast, and then shortly after that a first aid drill. I wonder what it shall be this morning. Will it be an imaginary snake bite, or possibly a goring by a buffalo, or possibly a car accident? Those are usually the sort of the three options that we go through. We'll see which one of us gets to play the victim this time. And on that note, it's time for us to end. So a big thank you to Brian. Brian, it's lovely to have you and the thumb back on board with us once again, as well as to Rebecca and Jerry in final control, and to Steph and to James on vehicles, Jandre and Viam. And most importantly, a big thank you to all of you. Thank you for joining us. I hope you've had fun. And we look forward to seeing you again on the Sunset Safari. Bye-bye, everybody.